All right, looks like I'm live. Well, welcome everyone to the show. My name is International Master Kostya Kavutskiy, and you're watching the Pro Chess League Playoffs. This is going to be a match between the San Jose Hackers, my home team, and the team I play for and broadcast for, against the Webster Windmills, who are a team of very, very strong Grandmasters from the Missouri State in the United States of America. Of course, they represent Webster University, the very strong college program run by Susan Polgar and Paul Trung, and very, very tough team. This is going to be really a very exciting match. Right now, we are following the game of the board two for the Hackers, Grandmaster Daniel Naroditsky. Of course, I'm going to introduce all of our players one by one. And this match is going to be crazy. This is going to be one of the most exciting matches I can feel, because there's going to be a lot of substitutions, a lot of different players playing. I think we're using, I think, 8 different players, and that includes 5 GMs. Webster is using more than that, 9 different players, 6 total GMs. There's going to be tons of substitutions every round. I'll try to take you guys through the action, and it's going to be a great day. I see Mr. Dhruva in the chat. Hello and welcome. Good to know that the show is working. And let me make sure that I'm following all of our games. We've got Daniel Naroditsky on board 2 playing against Grandmaster Ilya Nizhnik. This kid is originally from Ukraine, my hometown, and moved to Webster around 2600. So the broadcast schedule is also going to involve some substitutions. I'm starting the show right now. In about 5 minutes, I'm going to be joined by Grandmaster Elshan Moradiabadi, a very strong GM who's living in Texas, around 2600 feet. He's going to do the coverage for about an hour with me, maybe the first 2 rounds or so. And then the usual guests are going to join in. National Masters Christopher Yoo and Teemu Virtanen, who are, of course, by now familiar to my Twitch audience. Okay. Let's see. I got someone telling me that the volume is too low. Looks like I have to adjust that. So thank you for letting me know. Let's see here. I'm going to increase the mic a little bit. Okay, I just adjusted the mic, so let me know if it is loud enough now, guys. I appreciate the audio check. It would really really not be great to have done a bunch of the show and then it turns out to be too quiet. So how's the audio now? Great, great. Looks like it's better. Also playing for the Hackers, Grandmaster Christian Kirilla. And he's on board 3 in this lineup. He's playing against Grandmaster Vasif Dorbaili of Azerbaijan. It might be hard for Mr. Vasif to play this match because he's playing against a couple of his countrymen. Both Mamedov, who's playing right now, and Mamedyarov will be joining the Hackers today playing their match. So it's going to be a lot of Azeris playing their games today. Okay, looks like the mic is still a little bit quiet, so let me boost it a little bit. Okay, let me know how it is now, guys. And here we have Rauf Mamedov. Let me flip the board. He's playing on board 1 here for the first 2 rounds. And just quickly go through his game. Looks like he played King's Indian, his favorite. And really interesting strategy by Webster here. So they put this girl, I think Talia Cervantes is her name, on board four for this lineup. Her feed is about 1800 or 1880. It counts as 2000 for the match. She's going up against Rafa Mamedov, our number one guy. So essentially, they're throwing her to the wolves here just so the rest of their lineup can be three GMs and they can have a very, very strong, lineup on boards one to three. So they're essentially, I don't want to say forfeiting this game, that's too strong, but this is not a game they're expecting to get any points out of, and the point was to lower their rating average a bit so that the rest of their three boards can contain very strong grandmasters. And indeed they do. Playing for board four on our side, National Master Ivan Key, the hero from last week, actually playing the same opening that he used in the decisive victory against the Dallas Destiny last week. If you weren't around for that match, I'd encourage you guys to check it out. At least the highlight reel is very, very exciting. And here he's playing against board one of Webster, Grandmaster Ray Robson, who's of course one of the best players in the United States, a member of their gold medal winning Olympic team. I think he's finished runner up at least one US championship. Really, really strong player, and he's going to be looking to score for Webster today. So really, this first match is going to come down to the matchups on board two and three. I think Ivan is a great player, but of course, he is a very, very big underdog to Ray Robson. So I expect both Webster and San Jose to win on the top boards today. And it's going to come down to the two matches, at least in this first round. Daniel Naroditsky against Ilya Nizhnik and Christian Carrilla against Vasif Dorabeli. Now, those of you watching in the chat, you might not know that we actually played Webster in the very first week of the Pro Chess League. And they were considered the favorites, you know, by all the pundits. But as we all know, at least in today's day and age, the media pundits don't really know anything when it comes to predicting results. So we actually won that match. We won handedly, thanks to the efforts of Christopher Yoo and Christian Carrilla was playing, as well as Shakma Majarov, our fearless leader, and Naroditsky as well. And we won that match, so this is technically a rematch. Since that match, of course, Webster has gone on to basically dominate the Pacific Division. I think they've scored at least six wins. They had a bye in the first week of the playoffs. And now, we're facing them again, and this is going to be a very, very tough match. And of course, we're going to wish our guys the best of luck. I really want to thank everyone for tuning into the show. I know a lot of you guys are students of Bay Area Chess. Hopefully you noticed the shirt. And it's always fun to have a very, very lively audience. Okay, right now I'm going to check my Skype options. We're going to have Grandmaster Elshan joining me very, very soon. And I believe he hasn't really done much commentary yet, so it'll be cool to see how he does. He's of course very quick and very good at analyzing positions, and it'll be a lot of fun. Just making sure my Skype settings are ready so that we have very minimal issues with the audio as soon as he joins us. Usually I like to start the call before the show, but not possible today. I got a little bit of a conflicting schedule. But the games, you know, they're progressing slowly. They still got plenty of time on their clocks. And I'll be sure to notify you guys if anything super exciting happens. I think I'll just stick to this game right now. It seems like all the pieces are on the board. You guys can watch how Dorabeli plays his hedgehog-type position and how Christian tries to make the most use out of his space advantage. Let's see here. Okay, I think I got my audio working well. And let's see. Right around 18-20 viewers. That's awesome. And okay, I'm gonna switch to Ivan's game real quick. So here we have his favorite F3 Nimzo. This has been one of the best openings for the hackers all year. This is the opening that Mamedov, of course, used to defeat Wesley So, hand him his first loss in his pro chess league career. And this was the opening that Ivan used to win the decisive game of last week's playoff match. Here, Ray Robson has played a little bit differently, and he's played this move c4, as you can see on the screen. And what we're going to get is a very unusual Benoni-type structure. But I kind of like Ivan's chances in this. I feel like he's had these kinds of positions a couple of times in the match, and in general, he's done very, very well. Now, he's under some concrete pressure right now with this last move, bishop b7. Ray is basically threatening to play knight takes d5 based on a number of pins in white's position. So now, Ivan's going to have to figure out how he's going to protect the pawn. His bishop b2, for example, black plays knight takes d5 anyways. And, can we recapture like this? Is this possible for white? Let's see. Maybe move like queen b6. No, I don't really believe it. So maybe bishop e2 here is working for white. And indeed, it has been played on the board. Ivan, if you're listening to the show, please turn it off. My suggestions are not going to be useful for you, unfortunately. And the real question is black going to be able to generate enough counterplay in this game? Or is white just going to hold on to his very nice space advantage? Because if white is able to consolidate, if white is able to castle and put his bishop on g5 or maybe e3, he's just going to have a very, very nice advantage in space. He always has this f5 square for the knight, especially since black's bishop is sitting on b7, is not going to be able to take there. And even more so because the pawn is going to be very hard for black to justify playing g6 here, given that his dark squared bishop is all the way out on b4. So this is a really, really dynamic position. I think against a player closer to Ivan's strength, I would really like Ivan's chances here, but obviously he's up against a very, very strong player in Ray Robson. Okay, let's switch quickly to Mamedov's game. Here we had the four pawns attack in the King's Indian, and he plays the typical e6 break to go into a kind of Benoni-type structure. White takes on e6, and both sides are developing their pieces. And black gives up the bishop in order to gain full control over the d4 square. Exchange on d4, a6. And this is the current position on the board after white's last move, rook fe1. Well, what can you say about this position? I think black is doing pretty good so far. In general, Mamedov loves positions with the fianchetto dark squared bishop. He's basically what I would say a dark square opening lover. All the openings he plays are always fighting for the dark squares, the King's Indian, the Sveshnikov. And all these openings, he always has bishop on b7, queen on b6, knight on c5. He's very, very comfortable with these positions. It looks like white has a pretty solid position, but white has some dynamic problems. Specifically, this knight on a3 is out of the game. It's very hard to bring the knight back in because knight c2 will hang the b2 pawn, and knight b1 does not really have a future so far. Meanwhile, black is ready to play rook e8 very soon and try and take the e4 pawn. So I think black is doing pretty well here, but of course we have only started the middle game. And let me jump real quick to Daniel Naroditsky's game. I haven't covered this game too much. This looks like a London system, which Danya has been playing with white in the league so far, so I'm sure he's fairly comfortable as to what to do here with black. And early f4 by white makes sense, take control over the e5 square. And black is able to exchange the passive light squared bishop. That's definitely a nice thing for black. Bishop d3, knight f5. And very solid position. Knight e4 kicks the rook back to c2. Queen d8. And black is in time to play f6 and kick the knight away from the very nice e5 square. Now, important thing here about the strategy of this position, it seems like it's white who has better control over e5 because he has two pawns controlling the square. Black only has one pawn controlling the e4 square. But strategically, this is actually better for black because he can still use the f pawn to kick the knight out of e5, whereas white can never use a pawn to kick the knight out of e4. And the only thing that white can do here is, as we now see in the game, is to put his knight on d2 and challenge black's knight on e4. So structurally, black is actually to be preferred in the center here. Now you return with knight d6, and now knight d2. So this looks like a very, very quiet, very equal position here. I expect black to soon play queen d7 and bring the other rook to c8. Meanwhile, Elshan is messaging me, so we'll try to get him on soon. And for those of you that were or weren't watching, there's been some big results in the league so far. I believe Norway did advance with Magnus Carlsen at the helm. Some of the other favorites advanced. Marcel advanced, which is, of course, led by Maxim Vachelagrav. And in the Atlantic division, it looks like Montreal, the Chess Bros, they advanced, which means Fabiano Caruana is heading into the... what would it be? The Elite Eight next week, as well as a small... surprise for some, perhaps, but Buenos Aires looks like they have defeated the Miami champions, which means that Nakamura was actually knocked out today. And his last game, by the way, was quite a sensational blunder, where he basically blundered a checkmate. Not a simple checkmate, but a checkmate nevertheless, and thus more or less cost his team the match. So that was quite exciting. That happened just before I went live, and I expect that I'll receive some coverage in the league recaps pretty soon. Okay. I'm getting Elshan set up and he'll be joining me for some coverage, which will be a lot of fun. And he is calling.
Hey Kostya, sorry, let me fix things.
Hey Elshan, no worries. We are live. And I'm gonna set you up.
All right, I'm here. Hello. Can you see me? Maybe I should turn this off.
I can see you.
Now you can see me.
That looks great. The only thing is, can you put in headphones?
Oh, absolutely. I actually got it here.
You're great. Don't worry, no rush. The games are... Nothing's happened yet.
Yeah, it's just... Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, is it better now?
Yeah, that's just to reduce the any kind of echo, so it doesn't go through your computer back onto the show.
I'm gonna click on stuff, so can you hear my clicks?
That's fine, don't worry about that.
Okay, let me see. Nizhnik Naroditsky, that's a nice game to watch. Can I open simultaneous games?
Yes. You'll see they show up as little tabs on either the bottom or the right side.
Okay, Joshua Sheng against... Oh, wow, look at this game.
Oh, we don't care about that game. That's not our team.
All right. Well, just saying.
But yeah, the San Diego Surfers are currently playing against St. Louis Archbishops. Actually, we can look at those games because we'll have a break in between the rounds, so we can check out how the other match is going.
How can I make all the games next to each other so I will not have to jump from one to another?
There is no way. You just have to click on each one as they are.
So Keaton is playing with Feingold, and Feingold played... Oh, wow, he played... Didn't go according to our preparation. He's a close Sicilian. So what are playing for your team? Mamedyarov and the other guys?
So right now we have Naroditsky playing, as you saw. Ray Robson, he's playing black against another one of our teammates, National Master.
And yeah.
Mamedyarov is playing right now as well. He's a little bit lower on the list. His username is MuisBack26.
What was the what's his username again?
It's spelled Muisback.
Okay, got it.
And he last played... game is Christian is playing against Durer Bailey.
I think I got that one already there. So Christian against Durer Bailey playing. Okay. Okay. That's...
So let's start on my game. So the way it's gonna work, I'll have the games open up on my screen, and then we just have to communicate to make sure we're talking about the same game.
Okay. Yeah. Well. What game is your game? I mean,
I think we can look at Christian's game. I think it's the most interesting one right now.
Yeah, yeah, I'm looking right now. In terms of time, just Christian. The game might finish soon because Christian only has 2 minutes.
Yeah, he's way down compared to the 8 minutes, and not a very fun position because it's like, I mean, White has to defend so many different pawns here, e4 and b3.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, who would you take? Let's say forget the clock situation. Who would you take in a game here?
Well, now after this exchange, I think should be even. Really, Black doesn't have b5 or d5, but maybe he has now. Maybe after rook b1, there is d5 here. Is there? Okay, he avoided that, but Black is fine now. Black is fine now. I mean, I don't know. He a little bit overpushed, I think. Those pawns could be vulnerable. You know, a famous game, you know how much I'm into classics.
Yeah.
to understand this position is a game, Karpov lost to Toure. In that game, Toure provoked a lot of push from Karpov, and then, ooh, look at that.
B5. Okay, what's going on here? So,
take. Bishop goes back to drop back to B7, maybe? Yeah. Bishop b7, I guess, right?
And then there's just so much pressure on the c-file.
Yeah, well, I mean, what about queen e2 there? I mean, this looks like venting off the pressure. Oh, b3 is hanging, shoot.
Oh, so we have bishop b7 on the board. I mean, what an uncomfortable move to play with Christian's time not being not being good at all.
Yeah, but b4. Okay, maybe he has knight e4, bishop e4, rook c3. Maybe an exchange sacrifice there. A little bit risky. But, oh wow, if he does that, knight d4, bishop e4, rook c3, there's bishop e7. Ah, there's rook g3. Is there rook g3 check? No. Because rook c2, bishop a8, rook c1, rook c1, rook a8, b6. And then, aha, he didn't go for that. Okay.
I like this move, just trade the queens.
Yeah, I didn't like knight d7. I think he should have taken his time and tried to calculate knight takes e4.
Yeah, that might have been working, huh?
Well, I mean, he didn't try. I mean, now white is having an upper hand for sure. Well, d5 might be played now, but then b6, that's crazy. b6 because now bishop c6, b5. So then b6 is hanging. No, I think he's going to play d5 now. I think now he's gonna play d5 because f4 is hanging, and after e5, then d4 maybe even.
Ooh, this is sharp.
Yeah, and maybe d4 is playable because bishop e7, queen b7, bishop d4, queen f3. Suddenly the king is exposed.
Hey, Elshan, let's switch over to the Robson game.
All right.
That one's
also
very interesting. So on board, on
I don't. Oh, well, let me find. Okay, Robson against the National Master. Who is he? Oh, Ivan K. Mm-hmm. Is he the youngest National Master or something he gained recently?
No, that is a different kid. Christopher Yoo is actually, he's going to be doing the commentary later on today. But Ivan is the hero from last week. He won two very important games last week, or maybe just
one. Wow, two wins in such tough tournament. In such a tough tournament, scoring 2 points, that's a lot. That's great.
Maybe he didn't score two, maybe one and a half, but he was definitely the big hero.
And he's on the run here. He's on fire here. He's better.
So why is he better here against Robson, you think?
Yeah, well, I mean, I see knight a2 coming. We have exchange, and the knight goes to that square b4, and then if knight goes to c5, e5, that looks really, I would say, irritating for Black. Otherwise, if knight c5, queen b4, then what happens there? Bishop e3. we have knight c to e2. Yeah, looks very good.
And
I mean,
knight coming to f5, right?
Yeah, f6 is hanging, and then e5 is, yeah, knight c5 doesn't work. If okay, you played this move.
G6.
Don't like this move. I don't like this move. Doesn't. How about knight a2 now?
I really like your knight a2 idea. I think that's great.
Just take the queen e3. It starts to be bugging, but. Maybe knight to e2. Okay, knight e2, then take and b4. Well, how about knight just knight g to e2?
Knight g e2?
Yeah, bishop e3. Oh, I don't like this h3. This looks like a waste of time to me.
Yeah, just making a look just in case later on. Well, we'll see. Well, there's pressure on Ray. I mean, he has to win this game because he's such a big favorite.
Yeah, well, there's pressure on Robson, but that's how his chess is all the time. It doesn't matter if he plays a 2100 or a 2800. He's always like this.
He's used to it. I'm going to quickly show the game that Mamedov is playing. He just won by resignation, uh-huh. So that game is over. He had bishop versus knight, a couple extra pawns in the end game, just hopeless position. And then we'll switch. Let's switch quickly to Naroditsky's game just to see how he's doing.
Naroditsky's playing against Nizhnik. Mm-hmm. Okay, this here, after, are we in the position after a4? What was the last move?
Last move is knight d2, move 35.
Knight d2, sorry, I'm moving 35. Okay. Well, Nizhnik.
If that king was on f2, the next move we would have queen takes c5 and knight e4. That'd be
great. That would be fun. Yeah, I understand that you're. You know, I am an impartial commentator here, but I understand you really want your team to win.
Oh, yeah. I would appreciate yes if you're objective. But yeah, you'll have to understand that in no way is it even possible for me to remain objective here.
Yeah. Yeah, I thoroughly understand that. I think here, f5, white has a 5, and it seems troublesome, no? I mean, e6 is hanging, queen e6 is coming. Oh, sorry, knight, just play knight d2. I don't have it on the board. Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
Bishop, queen is hanging. Sorry, queen is hanging.
So he has to figure out where to
put the queen. Oh, wait a second. Not maybe he's in trouble, actually. Where the queen is going? Queen d5 check is coming.
Oh, that's right.
And I don't have knight d4 because knight takes queen and defends the queen on d6. So there, I cannot offer exchanging the pieces. I cannot. Wow.
Oh, well, yeah, potentially, you know, queen b4 check and then queen d5, and white doesn't have king f2 because of this
queen c5. Yeah, and queen king c3 the same, because I thought I can go king f2 and f3 is covered, but again, there's queen c5 check.
But if he goes to h3...
Well, what about the key... Well, what do you mean? Which moment? After queen c3 or after queen b4?
So queen d5 check, king h3. Let's put the queen on b4 just so it's protected.
Okay, he played queen d3. Oh, he found this. All right. He conceded to an... No, he didn't concede to anything, in fact.
Okay, we should switch, actually, to Christian's game. Looks like he's up a piece. But again, the clock is running very, very low.
Yeah, and actually, you know, he doesn't have enough material. Because if suddenly those... Oh, wow. Look at that.
Oh.
Look at that.
Very nice. Christian, he's going for move of the week. I don't know, Elshan, if you saw, but Nakamura actually, his team lost.
Uh-huh.
And the last game that Nakamura played ended with an amazing checkmate, like queen sacrifice and then checkmate.
Against who? Did he win?
They were playing against Buenos Aires, so Naka in the last game, he was playing Grandmaster Mareko.
Uh-huh. And he won or he lost?
Naka lost. So Mareko won. Lost. Very nice queen sack.
I didn't see that. I was busy today, so. But look at this. I mean, this is awesome. This is close to winning, no? I mean, h6, what's happening here? He really wants to keep that pawn on the board. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Okay, now.
Now,
he just doesn't have enough time.
Yeah, oh, he traded the bishops. But, you know, if we have rook and two pieces versus rook and minor piece, is that winning, do you think?
It is a draw. It is a draw.
Oh, okay.
Okay, now it's a draw. I think it's a draw now. Yeah.
Unless he finds a way to keep the material.
There is no way for that, I think. Oh, wait a second. Knight e4. Rook c4. Yeah. Whoa. Ooh. Rook c6 now. Okay. Doesn't work.
So it looks like they're going to liquidate and draw. Okay. So
why didn't see the f5 check? Wow. These guys are funny.
Oh, f5. That would have drawn the game immediately.
Yeah, you would have. Yeah. But. Okay, so let's switch. This is going to be a draw.
We'll play this
song. Is going to be a draw, yeah.
Okay. Looks like.
Let's go back to Nizhnik. Nizhnik is, I think, is in trouble, I think, now.
Yeah, pawn up.
Can we go back there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm
yeah, looking at there. Look at this. Okay, I think Naroditsky is much better. I mean, of course, he's a pawn up, but how are they doing on time? Okay, he is in trouble.
You stay in this game. I'm going to check Ivan's game real quick. Looks like he's in trouble. He's down a pawn against Robson. And they're in just a furious time scramble here.
Yeah, I think it's dead lost, actually.
And white is just too passive here, yeah?
Yeah, it's just dead lost. It's like the bishop down. Just, right. Okay. And it's just going down. I think we can see the final phase. I think it's probably will finish in a few moves. Yeah.
And queen is coming.
Yeah, queen e3 or something, I don't know, queen f2. Well, many ways should win, but okay. Even can take on g2. Oh, wow, he was about to be flagged, my god.
Oh man, if the internet could just disconnect in Missouri for 1 second.
Okay, it's time to resign, I think. Okay.
You know, we told our players, actually, we gave them strict orders not to resign. Because, you know, crazy things happen in this league. Okay, well, there you go. All right, switching back to, pawn end game.
Okay, I closed Robson, and where are we at? Has Christian also drawn, or is he still playing?
So last game is Nerdist.
Nizhnik. Yeah. Okay. Oh, wow. What happened? Oh, wait a second. He's losing now.
Oh my god.
Oh my god, this is game over.
Oh no, what a turnaround.
Yeah, that is disastrous. That is disastrous. I cannot believe my eyes. What happened? Why did he play?
We need to rewind this game.
Let me see. I'm on move 49, h3 check. e5. Queen f7. Why he just didn't take on f4 or something? What is king h6? I mean, I don't get it. And then I don't get it. And he didn't take on g3. That is so dramatic.
And then this pawn endgame. I mean, is this bad for black?
No, I think he just lost objectivity. I mean, he tried. What's king e4? I mean, just play g5.
Oh, I see. It's king just, e4 is a blunder.
Well, I don't know exactly if it's a blunder, but now he has to be very, very, very precise to make a draw. I think it's a blunder, actually. You're right.
Okay, well, I'm going to switch to Christian's game because he's still going. He's trying to convert with the rook and knight.
Well, he's not trying to convert. He's trying to get something out of it.
Fair enough. he's got the king on the back rank, but I mean,
it's way too easy. It's way too easy. You know, if it was bishop, I would have given it to you. But knight is way too easy.
Yeah. I've played this a few times over the board. Yeah, and it's very hard to make a threat even for white here.
Well, actually, I lost once with the knight, but I ran into checkmate in one. Actually, I was not even he was not against Hari Krishna. He wasn't even threatening anything. I just ran into checkmate myself on move 48.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm hoping for here. You know, the same. Mm-hmm. Let's see. They're on move 100. They reach this move. So he has like five moves left, basically, before the 50 move rule will kick in.
Does it kick in or?
Yeah, the player, they have to hit draw, and then the server knows when 50 moves is up. King D1, come on.
That's how I lost, actually. That's how I lost to Hari Krishna. I moved 48 or something.
That would be a dream.
No. Is he gonna hit the draw or something?
Yeah, at this point, I think if either player hits draw, it should be. Although, let me see. When was the last capture? Exactly. Oh, actually, it was move 80, because they had that pawn left on the board.
So 80 is like 10 more moves to go.
Yeah, 10, yeah, 20 moves.
Yeah. I mean, 80 is 110. Sorry.
So.
Yeah.
That's a shame. I mean, that is not a position Nerditsky should lose.
No, it's unbelievable how he lost that.
Yeah.
What is Durabin thinking about? I mean, just rook back? Rook B2 check is dangerous. Oh, okay. Okay, I think he started to panic. That's a good thing.
Yeah, he's finally under a minute, I think, the first time in the game. And...
Yeah, but... Okay, that act is very irritating. Why does he click draw? I mean...
I think he probably doesn't know when the 50 move rule... You know, when the 50 moves is up, he didn't check, so he's just clicking it because he thinks he might be losing.
Actually, he's. Wait a second.
So now the threat.
Wait a second. Now he's stuck in the back rank. Wait a second. What's going on here? Huh? Like, if you go rook to g8, I have check on check, and knight before check is checkmate, and then rook a1 checkmate.
Mm-hmm. So he has to. I think he has to keep the knight pinned.
And then if I give it, okay, what's he thinking about?
Okay. Rook H3, he found it.
And what about King B3? Oh, then that doesn't get anywhere. You see, you even get the king to the corner, but this isn't it that famous position there? How about King to A3 now? Is that a 6-1 or something? It's not even anything.
Knight f4, I like that move.
No, but then King C1 gets out of the corner, huh? Oh! He built it! Ooh, he won!
This is move 120. Ooh, this is very close, actually. So check.
He built it, yes!
Mate? Come on.
Yeah! Woo!
Oh my god, I think that was past 50 moves. That is amazing.
Is that past 50 moves? It's not.
Move 80 was king takes f7.
Yeah, that's move 43.
Oh, you're right. Of course. Oh my god.
Well, yeah, what happened? I mean, unbelievable. Why did he even get to this position? Because, you know, the only idea is that just don't get pinned. I mean, after this, just play rook there. To c8, rook c8, and if check on b2, and move one, talking about move 111. Mm-hmm. Rook c8, do I get checkmate or something? I don't see anything.
That is you just have unbelievable.
Yeah.
But you know, I mean, we were so unlucky on the Naroditsky game. I feel like that it should have been two draws, right?
Yeah, so basically, yeah, it kind of Kaisa leveled things up.
Wow.
That was amazing.
Good job. So that's, you know, we have a tradition. Every time someone scores a big win, you know, they get a milkshake. So.
Oh, do they? That's.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd like to be on that team.
So actually, the next round has started.
All right. Well, let me close my pores and get there. You know, I'm very not good with still. So next game is. Okay.
So we've got Nizhnik, he's playing Mamedov. That'll be a very, very interesting game.
Ah, and he played e6, and he was 1 minute late to make e6? Wow. You see that? He lost a minute.
Yeah, maybe he went to the bathroom or something, I don't know.
Durability playing against the National Master from your team. Oh, he played this d4 line.
Durability's playing Ivan. I hope he's furious, you know, after that game. I hope he's fuming and he's going to...
Overpushing?
Overpush, yeah. Exactly.
Well, let's see. Good luck to you guys. Let me see, what are the other games? Naroditsky against... who's Joshua Colas? Mm-hmm. Okay, guys, Naroditsky is playing Joshua Colas, okay. So, what are your games? Durability against...
And I think the fourth game hasn't started yet. Christian should be playing.
I think... Yeah, I don't see that game yet.
Okay, I'll keep an eye out for it.
Okay. So let's have a look at Colas, Naroditsky against Joshua Colas. Mm-hmm. Okay, we have this main line that was Kasparov's favorite. So let's see. Okay, he goes. Okay, h6 is already inaccurate. I think we are gonna see it. Okay, this is already bad. This is already bad.
Yeah, so I know Josh Groves pretty well. I played him a couple of times. He's a friend. He's not super theoretical in the opening. He's good middle game, good end game player. But in the openings, he keeps it very simple. So he plays a lot of stuff like
this. He made a mistake here. Naroditsky, instead of playing bishop to h4, he had to play bishop f4.
Oh, bishop f4 was better here.
Yeah, because bishop f4, instead of, black doesn't have knight h5 because you take knight d5. That's called Rubinstein agony. He lost twice like that.
Rubinstein lost with black like this?
Twice, not once, twice.
Wow.
So, yeah, that's why they call it the agony. He lost twice, yeah.
I didn't know that.
So bishop f4 and knight f8, he could play h3.
Uh-huh.
And that is like... something, or maybe you don't have that, you don't need that. You can play rook e1 because knight h5, you can go bishop e5, something like that. Wow. I think bishop h4 was already an inaccuracy. So here,
but you know, I've looked at these positions a little bit. I've always thought that instead of knight f4, white can take and play knight g3.
Hey, but then there's knight f6, that your knight is misplaced, and that if you don't have f3 in time, then this h5, h4 is becoming really a pain.
And f3 is not working here because black will take in bishop g4.
Yeah. But now f3, now is a threat now. Mm-hmm. Now is a threat now. And move like g5 don't work because we just drop knight back and now we want to play f3. Now knight f6 was an inaccuracy. Now f3, f4 is a real threat, and I see black is in danger now.
We're going to see a lot of inaccuracies today, as you might expect.
Yeah, but this one is one that can lead to a lot of bad things to him, mm-hmm. for him. So now he played bishop d7, f3 I think could be played soon. f3 is going to come, but let's have a look at two strong... two heavyweight players, Mamedov playing Nizhnik, and they are playing, oh wow, he played this line with ed5. Mm-hmm. He played this line with c4. Interesting. Q1, bishop f5. Yeah, this position, always white has some symbolic advantage, but I'm not sure if it's a long-lasting one. So, knight d4. One way to play is to take on d3, put knight on e5, the other one on c6, but I'm not sure if the best way to do it. Okay, he will spend some time to make a decision there.
Have you ever played against Mamedov, Elshan?
I only have played once in Blitz, but that really doesn't count. I haven't played a rapid or Blitz or classical game against it. Oh, wow. Look at the pawn sacrifice.
It should be 4. Okay, so let's say we take. What happens?
He probably wants to take the queen d5 and then rook d8. He's probably looking for c5 is hanging, and then a5, a4 is coming. Knight on d4 is kind of loose. Wow. So
it's a very creative idea.
Well, I mean, I'm sure he wouldn't have played that move in a classical game, but now he doesn't have enough time. Has Christian's game started yet? I don't see it.
Yeah, I don't see it either. I'm not sure if that's. I mean, I'm sure he's online. I don't know, because you know Webster, they're making so many substitutions in this match. I don't know exactly who's playing for them in which round, because Robson, I believe, he's only playing that one game. That he just won, and because see they just brought in Josh Colas, which means that their rating average has gone up, so Robson can't be in. I think they were supposed to bring in Denis Borosh, but I don't see any games.
Nizhnik, interesting. Now,
oh, it looks like Borosh is having issues connecting.
I don't know what's going to happen there, but...
You know, we played Webster in the first week of the regular season, and in round one, Mamedyarov couldn't get in and was actually forfeited.
That I remember. That I very well remember. Oh, wait a second. What happened here? He got into some trouble? I1K has a good position now, looks like, right? There. Oh, either he's in trouble or he got some good position.
This feels like a theoretical line to me. I feel like this is some theory.
Doesn't look like a theory to me.
We're all mixing it up, but
no, it is theoretical. But this d5 doesn't look. I mean, this queen a5 check. Haven't seen this one. It's either a blunder or white blunder somewhere.
Yeah, I mean. Dior Bailey spent 2 minutes on c takes d5. Is d5 an unusual move?
I don't think so. But d5, what about bishop f4? I mean, wait a second. Couldn't white go bishop f4?
Then maybe e5.
Then bishop. I mean, try to make it a little bit crazy. I don't know. C take d5. Because now if queen a5, I go back queen b5, dc6. I don't know. I mean, it just looks like way too many tempi, and those. And if when I castle that diagonal can become very critical. I don't know. I whenever I have played this line, I studied it before the game. I never had it memorized. But knight f takes d4 looks like a normal move, but now d takes c. Okay, now this position d takes c6. How about we play knight e7 right away here? Because cb7, bishop b7 looks fantastic for black, actually.
Yeah, of course.
But there's this a4 coming, is kind of irritating. But if knight e7, a4, we have queen b4. I think knight e7 looks very good for black, actually. I don't know.
Yeah, I definitely like it. Yeah, that's the thing about rapid, is that if you get caught or surprised in the opening, you just don't have time to come up with very precise ideas. You have to find something good and just go for it.
Yeah, it looks awesome actually for black. He's already, the pawns are equal, so if he plays knight e7, a4, queen b4, if cb7, bishop b7, a4, again queen b4, okay, there's not a difference, just cb7, bishop e7, takes queen a4, check queen c6, that is awesome too. I think knight e7 and oh, okay. It started blue wizard against Christian. So,
oh, great. So here Christian is playing Denis Borosh, who's a little bit low rated, yeah. But I mean, pretty solid grandmaster.
Actually, a very, very colorful grandmaster, but solid in the sense that he knows the kind of chess he plays. So,
yeah.
Okay, we see a Torre opening. Mm-hmm. I used to play that. Actually, I became a GM playing this opening. That's kind of funny. You know, playing. You would expect that when you want to become a GM, you want to play something sharp and you know, something well known. But that was my opening when I became a GM. So here we have the usual triangle of known as Collet triangle of C3 D4 E3. And I don't know where Danish wants to put his bishop. I would put it on e2, because if I put it on d3 after cd4. Okay, oh wow. Bishop c4.
I thought white normally takes on c5 and then plays like bishop c4, bishop e2.
Well, that's when the bishop is on f4, not on g5.
Oh, okay. By the way, Elshan, if you have anything to promote, any kind of Twitter or Facebook, now would be the time.
Well, I have my Twitter. I don't have my, I don't prefer my ID. I always put it as my, so my Twitter ID is Eli_1985_MOR. That's my Twitter, and I post materials there, usually chess stuff. I write right now, I'm working on an article about how to work on chess in the 21st century. Mm. I'm working on that, and I was covering World Women Championship, and I'm planning to cover other tournaments that are coming up. So I'll post my material there about chess, and also, that's where I post my stuff, and my email is just my first name. That my.
Oh, you don't have to give out your email. Don't worry. You're gonna get some stalker.
That's out there already. It's on my chess.com. Mm-hmm. So whoever likes what you're right. You're right. Whoever wants to reach me as a chess player, they can reach me. Believe me, I receive a lot of spam every day. So. I got used to it, I think.
Nice. Yeah, actually, so we have a lot of students of Bay Area Chess watching right now. You know, we have these group classes, the BAC teams. So Christian and Daniel, they coach the elite team, which is players basically 1,800 all the way up to like 2,300. Quite a strong group. Then I teach the second team under that, the A team or advanced team. These are kids like a little bit lower, 1,400 to 1,800. And a lot of them are watching the show today.
I say hi to them, and I want to say how lucky they are to have such a strong group of coaches there, and that's definitely is exciting. I wish when I was their level, I wish I had coaches like this. So because I haven't had until I reached like 2250 level FIDE, which is like 2300.
Right.
So that's great.
We tell them all the time. It's such a luxury.
It is indeed. At least take it from me. that's very exciting, and I'm sure some of these players will turn into. I may not be fully professionals, but 24th like IM title or even GM title. That's exciting. You do a great job, guys.
Yeah, absolutely. And by the way, for my students, I don't think most know this, but I actually work with Elshan on my own chess when I have time. So when I'm not training you guys.
You do you do good. You do good. And I'm glad that we managed to get your title. You played very well in the St. Louis, and you got the title finally. With a little bit of heartache for me, that game with Angelo Young, but you pulled it together, so great.
Final game. Yeah, I'll never forget that.
Me either. I was watching, I was like, gosh. I told Sabina, my fiance, and she's also a woman grandmaster. Those who don't know, he plays several times for the US national team. We were watching, I was just like, I just close it. This is just, he's not going to win. I just opened it and said, wow, he won.
Yeah, I still don't believe it myself.
I was like, oh gosh. I was like, Yeah. Well, okay. I'm looking at the game. Mamedov against Nizhnik. I think Nizhnik misplayed it somewhere. He seems like a pawn down with not sufficient enough compensation for the pawn. Do you follow that game?
Yeah, I'm on. I just saw Rook e5 on the screen.
Yeah, Rook f Knight f d4, Knight e3, Knight c6, bc6. Rook e3, it's not fully a pawn, but he He's got good chances. Knight FD4. It looks like enough. It looks like good enough advantage. I don't know what he's looking at, Mamedov. I mean, he's a very strong rapid and blitz player. Let's see, Durabelli. Ah, he got a winning position, Durabelli. He got a winning position. Oof. Yeah, that is dead lost. Just.
So we did have a4, queen b4, b3. Took on c6 with the knight, and his king gets caught in the center with his bishop on a3.
Ah, that's what they failed to see. But after d3, I would go for the crazy idea d3. Why he didn't go d3? That should be the way to play it, I guess, no? D3 is the move, I guess.
It looks principled, so bishop a3.
D takes e2. And queen e2 and queen b6. Yeah, I think.
Knight c4 and then.
Oh, shoot.
Knight d6.
Yeah. So I think that's how he misplayed it, and now we know. We learned something. At the expense of Ivan. But probably even knight d5 here was better than... Okay, d3 is probably not good, but knight d5 is probably a better move here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's tough. I mean, if you don't get out of the opening against the GM, it's just... It's impossible to... I mean, this looks like a... I mean, just dead lost position for black.
Yes.
I mean, extra dark squared bishop can come to f6 whenever he wants and...
Yeah, that is true indeed. Kostya, sorry, I need to a little bit log off and log on to my computer. Something happened. Just my browser froze. So I'll get back to you in a second. Is that okay?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, sure. Sorry.
Yeah, of course. Meanwhile, I'm going to switch. We're seeing Naroditsky's game here. Looks like he advanced on king's side.
I'm back. Is that okay all? Okay, I didn't lose connection, I guess, right?
No, I think you stayed on.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah, just sometimes this happens. I don't know. Just... Okay. Are we looking at Naroditsky's game? Let's have a look.
Yeah, Christian. I'm seeing the position after black played c5 and g4 and h4. So Naroditsky starts advancing.
I don't think he has enough advantage. He might have missed something somewhere. I don't know. Or maybe just I'm not following the most recent theory well enough. Wow, he played this knight c3, and Naroditsky took with the b pawn. Yeah, I wouldn't take with the b pawn. I'd probably take with the queen and play b4, bishop b1, knight d3. Mm-hmm. But c5 and then g4 there. I think, well, what king g2 you should, I mean, it's very, I wouldn't like to play this one, this position, in either color. I will never enter this position in rapid. No, don't get me wrong. Position is just fine. Mm-hmm. But I don't like to play this in a rapid.
I mean, you said for either side, this wouldn't be good for rapid?
It's not my style. Like, for example, if white wants to double his rook, rook f2, what happens after bishop takes g4? I mean, that is a very tough question to answer. Mm-hmm. Because, like, bishop g4, f takes g4, knight g4, rook fe2, knight takes e3, checked, rook f3, queen takes f4. What a headache. So, I cannot play queen rook e2 either. There is queen f4. It's just it's way too exposed.
That's a nice trick.
I know Naroditsky is a very principled player, but I mean, practically speaking, I just don't like to be in his shoes now. Like knight d3 runs into bishop g4 again, take knight d4, and suddenly queen g3 is like a devastating check.
Wow.
So there are way too many tricks here going on, and if I were him, I probably would have gone knight h3, knight f2, trying just to cover things. But that is just positionally bad, because knight h3, then maybe h5, then g5, bishop h3, check, king h3, then knight d7. That is heading to b6, c4. And white's attack is just at the end of it. And black has like a 2 against 1. Maybe black is just better, actually.
Yeah, I mean, what a strange position. It's like white just kind of... Both sides just set up everything. But yeah, white has... is very much in danger of being overextended here, yeah?
I think he already did. And I'm worried about Narodiski now.
No, he's taking his time here. So clearly he understands something has gone wrong, looks like.
Yeah, he's in trouble. Durabil is winning. Let's see. It's just... That is just... Yeah, I mean... This position is just more than whatever my imagination could take it. So
let's switch to Mamedov's game because we've had some changes there.
Yeah.
So d4. We left off rook e5, move 21, g4, g6. He took a second pawn.
Yeah, but then his position is sort of exposed and. Okay, now.
Got the live position after knight f3. So I mean, white is two pawns up, but I mean, all of the pieces are bad, and g5 pawn is hanging.
Not convinced enough with this position. I think Mamedov's advantage is gone. Black is way too active now.
Mm-hmm. So if bishop b2, for example, black will take, or make some other move.
Bishop where?
Bishop d2.
Bishop d2 take and bishop... Bishop f4, knight d4. Bishop d2, interesting.
Maybe there's some f5 or f6 there?
Well, f5, then I just go bishop c1.
Oh, sorry, I meant after knight e4. But, okay, knight g4 is played. So he gives back one pawn. He's going to try to consolidate. Bishop a5.
Oh, well, wait a second. Ah.
So takes, takes, knight takes, b7.
Is
a threat.
I think it's... Oh, wow. Bishop b8 is forced. And then I go bishop b8, bishop d8. Then if knight h3, I go knight a5, but bishop d8, I go knight e6. This is a crazy position. This is not easy. Oh, bishop f4. I don't like this move. It doesn't make sense to me. That square belongs to the knight.
Mm-hmm.
This doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, it's such a great intuition, just like...
What's that?
I mean... Like, in the time, like, I saw the move, I'm like, okay, is it attacking anything? And you're already, like, that's not the right move.
No, I don't have a great intuition. Otherwise, I was much higher rated than what I am. But it just, that is square, that is for the knight, you know? You want to do something going to d3 or something. Just black's piece is a little bit awkward here. I don't know. Maybe there are some specific tactics, like if... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, very unusual endgame.
Yeah, I think he's gonna play f5 now. I think he's gonna play f5 and then knight to e3, bishop e3, f takes e3, knight e5. Ah, then we have knight a5. Maybe he's winning now. Because if he wins the pawn on b7, that's probably winning for white.
Very strong, right?
Yeah, I don't see... You see, if that bishop was on b8 now, he could go knight f4, knight e6 or something. Or that knight could go back to e6. I don't know, I didn't like this knight f3 either. There's knight e2 check here. But take, take, and then bishop g5, maybe? But then take knight... Yeah. Doesn't look right for me. Let's go back to Naroditsky. Aha, he played queen f2. I don't like rook c8 by Kolas. This rook c8. Why he didn't go bishop g4? You know, move 23.
Queen f2, bishop takes g4, huh?
Yeah, it looks very dangerous to me. Is there any specific tactics there? I don't see anything. Takes and then e3 takes. I think he missed it. What is rook c8?
Yeah, hey, bishop he g4. Won so many pawns and then he's going to win the rook on it. That looks, I don't know, it looks great for black.
Yeah, I think it was, he could just finish him off right away.
But, you know, they both spent 2 minutes calculating there, so they both must have seen something. You know, 2 minutes on queen f2, 2 minutes on rook c8.
And now he blundered, take, take, knight, h7. And what is that? Well, no, knight should go to h7, take, take, knight. And now it's game over, knight d5 is game over. Ah, yeah, knight d5.
Knight d5, just taking the pawn, hitting the rook.
Yeah, well, because knight goes to e8, and then rook goes back to e8, sorry, and, okay, a4 is coming, but I just can't go e4 myself. A4, I go bishop d1, or even bishop c2. Yeah, I mean...
It's looking good for white now. It's kind of turning.
Yeah, I think even bishop d5. Oh, actually, bishop d5 is even stronger. Because then I don't have that a4 worrying me. Oh. Queen he d3? Wants to give knight... Yeah, he wants knight h5 check. That's a good move for
when
blitz.
When you see a good move, play a stronger one.
Yeah, now h5 is a danger. Now, okay, now he is in big trouble. Now, okay, Naroditsky is in charge.
He's taking over.
Yeah, let's have a look at the game between Danish and Kirilla. Danish has a completely shattered pawn structure, but he has that weak pawn on b6 eyeing on. He is also eyeballing that c7 square with his knight. Yeah, the weak pawn structure doesn't do much harm to him right now.
Oh, Elshan, you know, we got the answer in the chat. So that line we were looking at earlier with knight g4 runs into the same trick of this knight h5 check. So black takes on g4 twice, white plays queen g3. And if knight takes e3 check...
There's queen g3. Okay, queen g3, right. Well, you know what? That's why the move like king g7 doesn't make sense in that position. Mm-hmm. You are running yourself into something.
So that line is brought to you by Christopher Yoo. That's the youngest master. He's watching the show and following very closely.
Thank you to him and his engines or whatever he found, because I don't have anything on, so I just come with my intuition right away. So
no,
I can I don't check.
That is not his engine. That is
I'm sure he can outcalculate me in several occasions. Okay, if I like this move played by Christian, because you kind of opening up b2, and then yeah, I think we should see a draw here.
Oh, so he's striking back, but again the problem with Christian is his time. You know, last game he got out, but again he's like 4 minutes to 9 minutes.
No, but this is a good move. De5, knight e5, bishop e5, bishop e5, knight c4. Yeah, I mean he's also a little bit in trouble right now. Should be equal, but. He is facing some trouble. Mm-hmm. What is this? Oh, la la la. Oh. Okay, now we have a situation here for Christian.
Wow, so he's trying just to take on c8 and the rook.
Now it's difficult. Now it's difficult, really.
Okay, can we play rook b8 here?
Or rook b8, then I go bishop g3, and then...
Bishop g3 is annoying.
What's that?
Bishop g3 is annoying.
Yeah, well, I mean, now I want to play knight c7, knight a6, d5, and then f... Yeah, that's, you know, way too many weak squares under control, and if I get my pawn to... Yeah. Yeah, Christian is a bit in trouble. Durabelli, did he finish him off? Yeah.
So Durabelli did win the game. Just going to show the final position. Yeah, I mean, king is wide open and dark sword bishop too strong in this case.
Let's look at Mamedov against Nizhnik. So this is a very interesting game.
Kept the extra pawn. Nizhnik is down to just 20 seconds.
Yeah, but the thing is that now, yeah, I mean, I don't see how he can improve now. Knight e2. Yeah, I think it's gonna be a draw.
So black has a very solid grip on the position.
Yeah, I don't see how he wants to improve. Oh, what a mistake.
Knight f4.
Now that knight is going to f4. He has g5. Can he play h5? No.
We'd love to, yeah. But knight comes back.
Yeah. Oh, he tricked the... Oh, wow, he tricked him. In his time pressure, he tricked Mamedov. Now black is just fine. Actually, he's going after all those pawns. That's a very juicy pawn on a3 and b4. My God. Mm-hmm. What did he play after h6, g5, knight, g5? Wait. Is it my... Is it something...
I think that's... I have it too. I think that's the server just lagging a little bit. Nizhnik's not flagging. I think it's white's turn in this position. It'll reset pretty soon.
Okay, let's go back to Naroditsky. Naroditsky is a healthy pawn up, and he's gonna put his knight on d5, I guess.
No, equal pawns.
Oh, he didn't win that pawn?
Somehow.
Yeah, it's equal
pawns.
He played
e4 for some reason instead of taking.
Yeah, he's very principled player. I mean, I would try to make to be more practical when we be up some material, you know.
Yeah.
But here he has a great idea of rook e2, rook c2, and knight c7, because rook e6 seems forced to me.
But it's just huge initiative here for him. I mean, it looks like the king never castled.
Should be winning. Rook e2. Okay, he played queen f4. I would have played rook e2, rook c2, but okay. Queen b8 check is very dangerous. Rook c. Now rook c1. F7. Yeah.
Okay, it looks like a lot of
stuff. Because king, queen f7, there's knight e7, but this is just like a killer. It's checkmate, I think. Okay, queen b5, queen c7, queen b8, rook c7. Yeah.
Okay, so Mamedov and Nizhnik have officially drawn. Looks like they found some kind of repetition there. So you're right. Uh-huh. I mean, black was just fine in that position. And then this game looks good for white. And
so let's look at a decisive game, which is going to be Christian against Borosh. And now Christian is in deep trouble.
Yeah, so we had rook d8, bishop g5, f6, bishop back to e3.
Yeah, now f5, good move. Very good move. Now Christian has good. Okay, now actually he's not in that much. Oh, he is in trouble. Bishop g7, knight c7. Doesn't he lose immediately?
Yeah, because I think he just found that. Take on e8 with check, so there's no rook takes d1.
I think he just blundered. Okay, that's not good for your team because that means that you are going to. Yeah, and his side, and I think we're gonna soon see a game over. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, it doesn't look good. Okay, so most likely, so Naroditsky has converted. He gave check to Queen of seven.
Yeah, that is it. And okay, this round didn't go as you wished, but
you know, so our strategy, we saw the lineups, because every round the lineups are going to be different. So rounds one and two are a little bit tough for us, just the board to board matchups. But rounds three and four, I think we have a clear edge. So we were hoping for even match by this point. You know, 2-2, 2-2. With Dennis probably winning this game, we're going to be down 1 point. But I expect good things in round three. I mean, we have Mamedyarov coming in, and Azoria as well is going to be on board too.
Yeah, well, Azoria is a very strong player, and he's a good friend of mine also. I mean, they're a very nice person and a very strong chess player. His rating shouldn't fool you. He's very strong.
Oh, he's done great so far. We've been very happy to have him. And then we're going to have Kasov Ruswanda on board three actually, and Faik Alaskarov on board four.
Oh.
So kind of a more balanced lineup.
Yeah, I think you there you have clear edge. I mean, obviously.
Yeah, so we'll be hoping to score big in the next round and then round four as well. What are your plans? Are you able to stay on, or do you need to
I think I'll leave you in a few minutes. I just want to see the end of this match, and we kind of have a wrap up, and maybe we can have a wrap up for now. I wish you guys good luck, because thanks for inviting me, by the way.
Oh, absolutely. Thanks for this. I learned a lot already. Just that one Rubinstein trick, Rubinstein agony.
That's a real agony. By the way, it's a cute position now. There's h4 in this position, in Christian's game. Mm-hmm. He just missed it but anyways, it really doesn't matter. But that agony is a true agony. That one, actually, I won a game like that. That is fun too.
Oh wow.
Yeah, and here I think Danish can play rook to d4 after knight takes b2. Okay, he played with f4. I didn't see there's a... Okay. Yeah. Well, I wish you guys good luck. So now it's 4-4 so far.
No, we are down 1 point because they took that round 2.5, 1.5. So first round was drawn.
Ah, you had 2-2, right. All right. So this round you lost, so you're down a point. So now this is going to be close, but with Mamedyarov now and Izoria, you're going to have a solid team.
Oh, yeah, we're going to bounce back. I know it.
Yeah, it's going to be close, so good luck, guys. Hope that things turn out well for you guys, and I really enjoy it. Actually, that game I was telling you about, Karpov Torre, if we can do another Twitch some other time or do something, I can analyze it for guys. That Torre won against Karpov, that was a sensation at the time, because any Asian player ever scoring against a world champion, I think that was the very first time.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah. I would absolutely love to have you back. Yeah, thanks for joining the show.
Absolutely. All right. Okay. Well, have fun, guys, and take care, Kostya.
See ya.
Take it. See ya.
All right, guys. Thank you very much to Grandmaster Elshan Moradiabadi for joining me. I'm going to now send a message to our other two commentators for tonight, which will be Christopher Yoo and Teemu, our local favorites. Looks like they are online. I'm gonna start the call. Don't need that one. Here we go.
Yes, I just copy on
Skype. Okay, and we are now joined by National Masters Christopher Yoo and Teemu Virtanen. Have you guys been following the show so far?
Of course, every game.
Yeah.
watching.
I need to get something.
Okay, I gotta update our gotta update our names here. Next round we'll be starting, I think, in basically 1 minute.
First of all,
Kostya, can you tell me if there's some background noise? Like, my family is watching TV right now.
Yes, I think.
There's a little bit, yeah. Very faint.
Oh. Okay, yeah. I'll tell them to turn down the volume.
So that was a very close round. That was advantage to Webster. They're currently leading.
Kostya, I'm gonna have to move my setup, so I'm gonna call you back in a moment.
Cool. You can just like rejoin the group call, and that should work. So go ahead and you can disconnect. All right, Christopher, what have you thought of the game so far?
Not necessarily our way, but we still have a okay chance of fighting back.
Mm-hmm. Well, absolutely. This next round, like I mentioned with Elshan, is there going to be some very interesting matchups. We have Mamedyarov coming in. He'll be playing one of their GMs. Azori as well coming in. And then on boards 3 and 4, we'll have two of our more solid players, Kasav and Fike. So let's see. The Mamajaro game has just started. I've just put that up on the channel. I'm gonna look for the other games now.
Yeah, I'm on chess.com. I'm trying to get it up. Yeah, Zoria, Mamadea. Is Kasov playing for us?
Yeah.
Okay. Kasov. I think we have a little bit of a better chance here. Fike, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. So we have Fike on board 4. He's playing Grandmaster Ashwin Jayaram, who was just substituted in by Webster. Pretty solid GM, this guy. He made his Grandmaster title, I think, last year. He was an IM for a little while. And then Kasov also has white against... not familiar with this player. Not even sure what his last name is. I'm going to call him Sepe. looks like Kasov has white in this... Pirt's defense, and Zoria has just come in. He's playing black against Ray Robson. This will be a tough game for him, but he has good experience here in this opening.
Okay, and, I'm back.
Yeah, welcome back. And lastly, the two compatriots are playing. Durabaili is white against our boy Shakhriyar Mamedyarov. I'm sure these guys know each other very well. They have been on the same Olympic team for Azerbaijan, but. This isn't the Olympics. This is the much more important Pro Chess League, and I expect blood in this game.
Yeah. That's quite a phrase to use.
Absolutely.
We already have some bloody game between Kasov and Sepasino, I see.
So there was a little bit of controversy, you know, in the previous round because, we have a draw. Never mind, we have a controversy in this round too.
a draw.
So he played the Zaitsev variation. This is actually a very well known repetition.
Oh, I know this repetition. I mean, why didn't Mamadeyev just go for the win? I mean, he didn't have to play Rookie A.
Well, this,
right? You didn't have to just repeat.
I mean, I think choosing this bishop b7 move kind of invites white to go for this line. There are other variations here where black doesn't allow this. Knight a5 or knight b8. So I don't know. Yeah. I think these guys are being a little bit too friendly with each other because this is, you know, if this game ends up being decisive for either side, you know, this could be a turning point in the match. But okay.
Yeah. You never know what crazy things might happen.
I mean,
so
kind of makes sense, you know.
What
Mamedyarov's playing black; he's a higher-rated player. I would not expect him to do this with white.
Right now, my Kasov's game, which came from a perk defense, where black goes for this move e5, and he takes, and he gets this e4 square. And I think if white takes on e5, black can take on e4. And then, I think that he could take on e4.
Yeah, that seems to be the trick.
And when he takes on f7, you could take on c3. So he just goes back to e2. Now, he's thinking about what to do. He could even think of the move like c5 here. But I don't like it, yeah, because you don't want, yeah. So he just has to figure out maybe a move like knight to d7 would be good, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he goes c6, so yeah, this move is, unlike c5, it doesn't let white have these sort of not necessarily connected passives, but
right.
Strong pawns that black doesn't want to allow to have.
He's,
this.
He's trying to he fight doesn't, back against that.
Yeah, he doesn't just want to get his knight to e5 and play that position, so he's opening things up with the move c6. So we're looking for an interesting game here.
Okay, let's switch to, Fike's game real quick, because this is getting pretty sharp. We've got exchange Caro Kann.
Okay.
Bishop b5 and early g4.
That's not Fike.
Oh,
wow.
Bishop e4.
Once again, Fike is angry. He's ready to attack against these GMs.
Yeah, I think he was like doing push-ups before the round or something, you know, get himself pumped up. But it's a sharp position. I mean, what's going on here after f3, for example? What is Black going to do with this bishop?
F3, bishop takes b1. I think that's the only move, because if you go back to g6, there's bishop f4.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that makes a lot of sense.
Giving up the bishop on b1.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
and then maybe hoping to play f6 with the idea of g3 being weak in some cases, forcing the knight off from the central square, and then white king is like weak.
Even for somebody that doesn't know the line, Teemu makes a lot of sense with that. The g3 square, limiting backs, white's castling. Not to mention that castling is actually a legal move for white here, but I'm not necessarily a big fan of.
No, but definitely not. That's under h5 in some.
Yeah. I mean, f3, bishop takes b1 is a nice move. So
this I'm is wondering sort of, if you think is about bishop f4. Oh, bishop f4 would have been a crazy line, but I don't think it works.
I mean, if bishop f4, at least queen b6, but I'm not a big fan, so. You really need to calculate why bishop to f4.
Mm-hmm.
Calculate bishop f4. Because it's a very sharp line, but okay, he just plays rook takes b1, he doesn't play bishop f4. So, I mean, he can just take the c6 knight and play queen a4, and that's sort of what white's looking for, that sort of position. Mm-hmm. To then play bishop f4 and stuff. I mean, so e6, he wants to get the bishop to d6, so Frank might consider taking the knight and playing queen a4 and going b4 and sort of playing that position.
Okay, that makes
sense. Or you can think of b4 right away and then do the same thing.
Yeah, I was thinking of c4, just trying to take the initiative as possible.
If Frank wants to make some complications, he might play c4. Or he plays queen a4 and b4, so...
Probably in bishop f4 here, right?
Yeah, bishop f4 seems very good now, because now you force the bishop to
I don't think that bishop takes c... Okay, what were you trying to say?
Well, bishop f4 here for white looks like a very nice idea, just threatening knight g6, and his queen on c7 is just not feeling... Okay, we see bishop f4 on the board. Black might have to play like queen c8 here. Okay, we see that.
I don't think my idea was good because my idea wasn't good because, I mean, I think white should keep the bishop pair at this moment because at this moment, these two bishops are doing a lot, so... I don't think bishop takes c6 is necessary if you're going to play b4. Even though you might think of his c-pawn being a little weak.
Yeah,
and
so definitely white
and backwards.
So maybe, you know, just bishop d3 and he just seeks to, you know, keep black from developing his pieces and then somehow maybe move bishop back to g3 then follow with f4, f5. Quick attack on the kind of center and the queen side.
Mm-hmm. B5, back out of positional desperation, he phrased this move. Wow.
Well, no, I think B5 is very logical because it's not even a position of weakness.
Yeah.
You know, it's very typical of this kind of minority.
I mean, what I mean is that he sort of has, I like this move, that he has to play this move. He's desperately trying to somehow equalize this position.
Yeah, I mean,
desperately
to complete his development here. You see knight takes e5, mm-hmm. It's going to bring the another in. But, I mean, if white does get that f-pawn rolling to f5, it's going to be pretty uncomfortable, even if black does manage to castle his king here. So I like Fike's chances here right from the start. I think he has a comfortable position.
Let's take a look at Kasov's game and how it's been going. I'm not a big fan of his position right now. I mean,
So g5, bishop f2.
I mean, black pieces are just better than whites. I mean, this bishop, even just bishop on d3 is not doing much. It's not very good. This bishop on e1's not helping that much. This rook on a1's out of the game. Black has these strong pieces like this bishop on e5 and even this knight on g4. And he can pawn storm. I mean, let's see what happens because it looks d3. Like Kasov sort of misplayed this.
Yeah, definitely something has gone wrong here for White because Black has just control over the dark squares. I mean, queen d6 or queen c7.
I'm not sure if he should have let h6 and g5 happen because then just knight g4 and now those pawns could potentially even pawn storm. So I don't think bishop to g5 and bishop h4 was. And bishop f2 was necessary.
Yeah.
That just sort of hurt White's position.
I think he underestimated this knight g4 idea.
I think it's very strong. I think the best move might even be a move like c3 after he played d takes c6 here. Maybe c3 might have been the best move, but then White needs to calculate moves like c5, where maybe then taking on d4 and then taking, and then he needs to figure out what to do in that position. Maybe bishop to c2, but then queen to b6, queen takes b4, that kind of stuff. But if he can play c3, d takes c3, I'm not sure. But I mean, whatever White does, I'm not sure if the whole entire idea of just getting his bishop to f2 was that helpful.
Yeah,
because
Christopher, just because we do have to keep up with the game. So we have queen d6, rook f3. It's like he's doing gymnastics here just to keep his position from collapsing, his Kasov.
But yeah, Black might play like bishop f4, bishop e3 check, followed by even h5, h4.
This is so inconvenient.
So passive.
Knight can come
so maybe queen e2, bishop e3, check, king h1, h5, maybe knight f1 is necessary. So you have like options with bishop g3 and h3, but it's so unpleasant.
No, I think white is just busted here. I mean, knight can come to e5, for example, after bishop e3, and then black's bishop other comes to g4, and the queen is just gone.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
I don't think he should have let even the move e5 happened in the perk defense because black gets this d4 square and he seems to sort of equalize. So that's sort of what white doesn't want when he goes f4, d4, e4. He doesn't want to let black play e5 and get a knight on d4 successfully. And then I don't like his bishop to g5 idea. So I'm not sure. Maybe that's the reason why it went a little downhill.
Okay, guys.
You never know. Need
to throw in some optimism here. We're going to switch over to Azoria's game. And he's way up on time.
Wow.
I mean, you know, we all hear about, like, time trouble addicts. Ray Robson is, I think, beyond helpless with the time trouble. I mean, every game, he's just... It doesn't matter. Blitz, rapid, classical. If he's not under 5 minutes, he doesn't feel comfortable. I mean, we got a pretty normal middle game here, but he's already under 5 minutes. And I mean, of course, he's just one of the strongest Blitz players in the world, is Ray Robson. So I think right now he's just in his element. He's going to start playing very strong moves. And we'll see if Zviad can put some pressure on him and try to score the minor upset here. Because having extra time in rapid is just so important.
Yeah.
So I like the clock situation here. And the position seems, I don't know, pretty okay for black. He's got the knight on b4. All of his pieces have some kind of job to do.
Yeah. This game could turn all three results, but I'd be comfortable if I was Azoria here, so... Let's take a look at Fike's game. So he did get F4 in Teemu, and Fike had some sort of agreement at the hackers team to play F5. And apparently he listened to Teemu's advice. So.
F5 on the board, takes, rook takes.
Teemu should be appreciating.
And knight c4. Annoying threat of knight e3, but this has to be good for White. I mean, this d5 pawn is so weak. As long as he can avoid this knight d2, or knight e3, knight d2 idea. So queen f3, knight d2 is again unpleasant. Queen E2, just dominate the knight.
Yeah. I mean, Mike is just doing well here, and there's nothing else besides that.
Just winning for it? I mean, the Viking castle.
Almost winning, yeah. E7. I have to say that this position is conditionally winning.
Queen E2. I was thinking maybe he can play Queen F3 anyways. Queen F3, Knight D2, Queen takes D5, Knight takes B1, Queen takes F7. Then there's like Rook D5, check. You can even take the Knight and then play Bishop E4. It just looks like Black King has no
Queen to F3 is castles for Black, and if White plays Rook takes D5, Knight to D2, I think, and if Queen takes D5, Knight to E3, but that condition certainly not good for Black.
We can get away with Rook takes D5, Christopher, because Knight D2, there's even Bishop takes H7 check, just taking a second pawn.
King H8? I don't know. I mean, I don't like it is what I'm saying. I mean, White's just much better.
Yeah, Queen D3, Rook H5. Yeah, I mean.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think Queen F3 would have been perhaps even stronger. But I like Queen E2, so I mean.
Yeah, Queen E2, just keeping it simple when you're winning.
Yeah, maybe Queen F3 is something he would have played in classical, but in Rapid, Queen E2 is a very pragmatic solution. You know, you don't have to complicate when you have such a good position.
Okay, he played Rook A7, but do you guys have any idea? I mean, why not Queen E6 here for Black? I mean, I was kind of expecting this.
I mean, Queen E6, Rook to E1.
You take on C4 and then Rook E5.
Oh, exactly. Okay, very good.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I mean, Black wouldn't want to be playing Rook to A7 at the end of the variation because. I mean, even if Queen D8, Rook E1, Rook A7, I mean, this bishop is just totally stuck there. Black is tied to the game with passivity, so. Interesting stuff by Teemu, I mean.
Rook A7, and is there a reason why we can't take on D5, or is Fike just looking for perhaps something stronger in the position? Like taking C4 and Bishop D6, for example.
It might be a bit annoyed that Rook D5 just castles and Black gets out of trouble, but I mean, he has sacrificed the pawn, but some compensation as White King is now the one that's getting attacked.
Is White getting attacked? I mean, worst case, we just take the knight on c4, or we just have, like, better structure, extra pawn?
Yeah,
I guess. Maybe just takes on c4, then king h2. White should be doing really well.
Yeah, White's under control there. I think he might be looking for... Maybe he wants to play bishop c4, and then Black would be forced to play queen takes.
Mm-hmm.
And then queen to e5 is his idea. But then castles. And then castles, just staying off.
Yeah. And queen d5, then maybe queen e2 or something comes in. Maybe not very pleasant. Okay, so rook d5, castles is on the board. And... I mean, I don't know. I think Fike objectively probably has a close to winning position here, but it's going to take some work. He has to consolidate a little bit. Okay, rook f1 I like, but I think b3 is also an idea here for White, just to kick the knight.
Yeah, not letting Black get in his house.
Exactly.
So Azoria looks like he's trying to get this f4 square for his knight. I mean, f4, g3, I mean, knight f4, g3, and it seems like it immediately kicks out the knight, but I'm sort of liking Azoria's position conditionally.
I think his main idea is to play knight a6, knight c5, and then maybe rook a8.
I'm not sure about what the knight's doing on b4 anymore, so Teemu pointed out a good plan of putting your knight to a better square, too. And then knight e6, and then knight f4, but that's really slow. So right now, Robson's looking to kick out this knight. I'm not sure if Azoria should actually move back. So he moves back to f6, which is a more preferable square than g7. And he might think of implementing the plan knight to a6 and knight to c5 right here.
Yeah, by the way, guys, you know, last week...
It's a good time.
We had, in addition to our own league match, of course, the San Diego Surfers were playing as Rio Grande, another team from Texas. Of course, we were playing Dallas. And in the California versus Texas matchup, we won both matches 2-0. So we beat Dallas and they beat Rio Grande. This week, it's California versus Missouri because we're playing Webster, which is located in St. Louis, and the San Diego Surfers are also playing the other St. Louis team, the St. Louis Archbishops. So right now, this is a battle of California versus Missouri. And in addition to winning this match, I just hope the California teams, you know, take it down.
Yeah.
Some interesting dynamics in addition to our own match. Well, Robson now is going down under 2 minutes. I feel like black is a comfortable position. Above this
queen, yeah.
Five. I think Zviad is just in excellent shape right now. Just playing quickly,
yeah.
And constantly.
I would much rather have him on c5. But I guess he maybe thinking that he needs to be kind of weak in his plan.
Teemu, I have another idea. It's c5, knight to c6. To maybe reaching the d4 square and maybe getting the knight to e6 and then rerouting to
f4. Whenever you play c5, you have to deal with knight d5, and even if you give up temporarily, it's still not very pleasant.
Yeah, out of principle, it's very hard for black here to give up the d5 square. It's just very hard. let's quickly switch to Kasov's game. There's been some changes there.
But because maybe there's some tactics after, like, c5, knight d5, black has this b2 pawn after he takes the knight, so. And after knight c6, knight d5, we can take, and play queen d4 and get the d4 square. But I think I like Teemu's idea better, but it's just an interesting idea that I bring up. It's not necessarily good. I was calculating a little bit and I found this idea. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see what he does. Knight a6 or c5 or even something else.
Yeah, so guys, I'm going to switch to Kasov's game now. I feel like his opponent misplayed it a little bit because he...
Yeah, so he has survived far, but it's still very unpleasant. And... It's hard to suggest even a move for right.
Yeah, this pawn on e3 is just such a thorn.
I think that our idea of the day is pawn in the face, because we just got one pawn in the face here. A very common idea mentioned by other commentators, pawn in the face. I think that black is threatening bishop to g4, but then, I mean, white can take on c4, so
right.
This is his idea. He's hanging on the gloves. He's barely surviving.
Sure, queen b3 can work here.
Like
queen b3, queen c5, you have queen c3, so that's something at least for white. And queen a7, now you can think about taking on c4, because bishop takes, you have queen takes e3.
That's
the queen
right.
On a7 is hanging.
And white is getting out in this case. Yeah, I think queen b3 is a nice move.
Yeah.
But still, I think Kasov might be a bit disappointed because he's not making more than a draw. And even the draw will be a struggle.
Yeah, I mean the position he had after 15 moves is just... Yikes. I think given that, and, you know, he's down on time, I think draw would be excellent result at this point. Especially considering we're doing well on the other two boards. I like Fike's position a lot, and he's just up a pawn, and Azoria is well ahead on the clock and doing well. So
yeah.
I mean, ideal is Kasov holds the draw here and we get a win on at least one of those two boards to tie the match and then go into the last round needing a 2.5-1.5 victory.
What? But we have worse tie breaks than Webster.
If it's 8-8, does Webster advance?
Yeah, 8-8 means Webster advances, so we'll need to tie the match in this round with a 2.5-1.5 score, and then we'll need another 2.5 in the final round. Basically, at this point, we need to score 5 points, or I should say 4.5, because Shaka drew like 30 minutes ago. we'll need 4.5 points out of the remaining 7 games. So totally doable, totally doable.
Yeah. It's happened a lot of times before, so.
And we see queen b3 on the board, so we'll see what the nerves are like for Mr. Sepe, because he course, realizes his position is much stronger, and he's playing a strong player, so we'll see if his nerves hold up. Kind of a sharp position. Let's jump back quickly to Robson's game. He's gotten his knight to f5, but he's also under a minute, so this is going to be a game to watch, because this is going to be bloody. It's going to be decisive.
It's heating up in Robson's game. Especially if Robson plays a move like f4. Okay, queen c3. Robson stays calm, doesn't want the complications with 29 seconds on the clock. Yeah. So, okay, makes sense.
Black is under a little bit of pressure. You know, I think on the previous one, Black was starting to play d5 based on undermining the knight. But now after queen c3, that is less likely to happen due to the knight on c5 being hanging. But even then, I don't know, take on e4 or something. Could be crazy.
This game is something that we really have to look at. Maybe Azoria should just play king h7 and stay calm for now.
Yeah, I always like this move, king h7, because it dominates the knight. There's no more checks from the knight.
Yeah. Knight domination. One move to three moves in just one move. Some impressive stuff.
Ooh, but Robson likes the Fikes game real quick, because we have a nice tactic on the board. More of a simplification tactic. This last move, rook d8. Hitting the queen on c6, so Black cannot just take the hanging rook. And if queen takes f3, we will take on f8, take on f3. White keeps this pawn, and the c4, a6 pawns are weak. I mean, I think this is a close to winning position for White. It'll take some technique, you know, rook b7, rook f2. But I think White has excellent chances here. His pawns are just so solid. Just bring the king in, try to win the c4 pawn, and...
Now queen f6, right? And no, I queen think f6, queen g3. Domination.
Queen g3, gotta be careful. So king g2, rook b7,
king g2, and rook f2.
Solid.
Yeah. I call Fike winning.
H4, h5 soon, and try to set in like h6, just checkmate Black.
I mean, we should really take a look at this Ray Robson versus Azoria game.
Sure, I think Fike has good chances of converting there, even with queens on the board. Might be a little bit tricky, but yeah, this is going to be a sharp game here.
This might be a surprising idea, but I think that Azoria...
So queen a8 is just picking up a second pawn on a6. Then queen f6 check, so Black doesn't have any tricks.
Oh, very nice.
Now this is becoming quite easy for Fike.
All right, go Fike. Very nice. He's going to beat a GM here, so let's wish him well. Chris, we'll go back to Robson's game right now, because this is... Oh, man, this is going to get sharp, as we just see h5 on the board. Knight c4.
I mean, why didn't Azoria just take the bishop on the last move? Because I think that I prefer that, because now he seems to get the a5 on, and that's not good for Black. So I was suggesting knight takes b3 and actually giving it up. And then Black would have better chances, but he goes here.
Yeah, knight c4. So
I'm getting a little
rook e6, right? Unless he wants to give up the exchange here. But then
it's still not that clear, so yeah, we'll see. I wonder how Kasov has been doing. So right now he's gonna try to get this e3 pawn. This game is freaking me out.
Kasov has just been fighting like a merino here, just playing queen e1. Man, how does Black hold on to this pawn though?
Oh wow.
Maybe f5 out of f5 fold in. E takes f5. Bishop takes f5. Rook takes e3. Rook c8. King f2. Bishop to g4. So f5 may as well be his idea. So not letting White get chances. But then White can take. Bishop takes f5. Bishop takes f5. Rook takes f5. Rook to d1. And then you can get his rook to d3 successfully. So very sharp stuff.
Yeah, f5 is a critical move here for Black.
Oh, wait. I know this game's exciting, but look at what happened. Azoria, positional exchange sacrifice against Ray Robson.
Ooh, a classic. H4.
Classics.
Man, just
yeah, but I think that's also kind of reasonable because if
it's losing
the game.
Wow, look at this. Look at this. These pawns are clamping down at white's position.
Yeah.
This is a brilliant play by Azoria.
Positional masterpiece, huh?
Yeah.
Wow.
Never afraid to give up material for positional benefits. Now he's just going to get his king to e5. And he should be just holding.
I think he's going to play for the flag.
Wait, there's knight takes a4. Oh, knight takes a4, there's c3. Oh no.
No, knight b6. I'm down. Knight b6. But then bishop e2.
Yeah.
No, rook c5.
Rook c5? Okay.
No, but then... No, and bishop b3? No, he goes here. Is he gonna sacrifice? That's ridiculous.
That's the only move he has.
Yeah, he messed it up. That was a blunder. Knight takes a4. Okay, he's gonna play on. Oh, he's down a rook.
Three pawns, so technically it's a finish.
Wow! Azoria, he wants the pawn on d4. Look at this!
And if he holds this...
What a position! I mean, Azoria might not be even losing here. It's absolutely ridiculous. Wow.
Yeah, it just gives the rook just to simplify the position, but basically... It's almost over. I mean, a little bit more.
Always drawing,
I mean, Robson's time pressure, so... I mean... A little bit of hope. You never know what happens in the pro chess game. So we're just keeping our eye on this game. Looks like Vike's just winning. Kesov managed to
Kesov turned things around. You know, he's got extra pawn.
That's nice.
Oh, no, never mind. No extra pawns.
No, but this is very difficult to convert. Maybe
King c3. Azori is activating his... What? What position?
We switched to Kesov's game now.
Vike...
But now just rook b2, and white is really slow to approach, so I don't think... he can just play like king s3, rook e2, and slowly bring his pieces closer and then run the d-pawn up. So he does have some chances, but I think if black plays really slow, like bringing the king in makes sense. But
yeah.
I think he should have started creating a path pawn on the king side. Not something like f6, that's too slow.
He needs to play h5.
He has to play h4 immediately.
Now he realizes.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe d6 here, and then if king f7, there's e5.
Yeah. Oh.
No, but rook f2.
E5, rook takes f2, yeah.
Oh.
I think he has to give up the 8. Or no, he's never winning that. Wait, no. Rook d2, there's just rook takes d2.
Rook takes f6. Some tricky stuff by Kesov.
Hey,
but
f5?
Yeah.
Looks like it goes back.
Rook f2 again. Wow. Nice tactics.
Now just the rook's one. Yeah, this transitions to a lost again.
Yeah, I don't like this. Why would he go back? Just play rook f5 and. Unless he's not in time.
Pretty sure he's not, but...
Yeah, rook a1, and then a2, and the king is too far. King f2, rook h1. Yeah, tough. I feel like, what's going on here?
Whoa!
I don't even
what's
know
going anymore. On?
Officially, Fike has won his game, so good job, Fike. Looks like Robson is...
Officially...
Has won as well. So we really need Kasov to hold this if we have a chance in this match. Win would be great. I mean, I don't even know what's going on anymore. But holding would be nice to see.
Well, I mean, he has two pawns. Now just, he's waiting for the king to come closer. Yeah, he might be even winning soon.
Wait, I'm out of my mind. Is Kesov winning?
No, there's
rook
no
A4,
way.
Rook A4, rook A4, rook A4. Come on.
Oh my god.
What?
He's winning soon.
What is... This position winning, I almost can't believe my eyes.
No, rookie too.
This is the pro chess league. It's professional rapid online.
Yeah, rookie 4. No, okay.
Well, no, now but no, he's fine. Okay, wait.
Oh man, actually, I think he might have. He might have had something there. We'll look at. Okay, good that he held the draw, but
yeah. Draw.
Okay. I'm gonna go back. So instead of
So it looks like it was a tie.
Instead
so
of king
we
h7,
have, we have to win 3-1.
If white had played e5 here instead of king h7, how does black make the draw?
I don't know.
Yeah, e5. No, obviously.
So rook e4, we just play king f7?
Yeah.
Check.
E5, wow.
I think Kasov missed this one. King h7, I think, blew the win.
Yeah.
That's too bad.
I mean, he gets his king to f6, and then g5 is always a tempo on the rook, so he gets e6, and then it's winning.
Yeah, and the two pawns are... Oh, man, that was... that would have been good. Oh, my God,
well,
guys.
Kessel fought with all he had, because his draw helped us. His lucky draw. I mean, it evened out. Luck evened out in the end.
Oh, my God, guys. We all missed it. G8 is check.
What?
He could have just queened. Oh, no.
Where?
Move 78. He could have just queened. We all thought, oh, rook g4 check. And
oh, my God.
That's illegal. See?
Oh.
I just found out from the group chat. That was Christian watching.
Oh, wow.
Oh, no.
Oh.
So that was, I mean, e5 would have been winning, but yeah, I mean, okay, he still has to convert this, but it's harder on black in this position, that's for sure. Oh, what a chance we missed. Okay, well, our players got to get ready for the next round. We'll be starting in about a minute or so.
Just half a point. If we win 3-1 in the last round, we can advance to the top 8.
So exactly, we will need 3-1 here.
Yeah, we need to warn our players that we need to fight for the win in almost all the games.
Yeah.
Unless our team can secure the draw to win the match.
No, I mean Webster will advance in the case of an 8-8 tie, and that means we need 3-1.
Well, we have to award Kessov for fighting, and we have to congratulate Fike for winning, but it'll be a tough next round.
Okay, but you know, this is it. I mean, round 4, this is where heroes are born, guys. So that means, well, we'd like Mamadiarov to show up and win his game. I think Fike will be playing Mr. Sepe here. I like his chances there. Kasov will be playing Ashwin Jayaram. And Azoria, I believe, will be playing either Dor Bailey or maybe another GM.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll wait for those games to start. Wow, what a chance. Okay, hopefully Kasov, because he's aware he missed it, so hopefully you can just forget about it, just focus on the next game. Oh, that's too bad.
So this is the last round. Board 1 playing against board 1. Board 2 playing against board 2. Board 3 playing against board 3. Board 4 playing against board 4, right?
Exactly right, yeah. The lineups that we're going to finish with, we'll just have board by board like in the Olympiad.
So what do you think our chances are with this sort of lineup?
I'd say like pretty good. I mean, we're gonna have a advantage on board 1 and board 4. Boards 2 and 3 will be closer to equal. So if we can pull out 2 wins
and 2 draws,
that would be the best. Exactly.
That would feel so good because we really want to We really want the San Jose Hackers to stay in the playoffs. It's been so fun commentating. So we want to continue enjoying this experience.
Yeah.
At least Kessov drew, which gave us slightly better chances, but he could have won. The games haven't started yet?
Looks like not yet. I mean, okay, I guess that it is kind of fair considering Kessov's position was basically resignable after like 15 moves. But, you know, that doesn't matter. This is the end game, and the guy messed it up royally. I mean, Black probably had a lot of winning chances there. He allows White these two pawns. And, man, well, what are you going to do? Got to focus on the next round. Can't live in the past.
Yeah. Oh, this is so intense. At least Fike scored us an important win in this round against OGM.
Yeah, very clean win by Fike. Really nice.
Yeah, nice stuff. We're still waiting for the next game to start. I think it was supposed to start at 8:50, right?
Yeah, there's, I think, a bit of a delay, as is usual. Game should start soon. Meanwhile, San Diego is playing against St. Louis. I'm not sure what the match score is. I believe it was tied at halftime, 4-4. In that match, St. Louis advances on the tied match, so San Diego will have to pull some magic in order to win that one. Very tough to beat Wesley So, you know.
Melick versus my coach Melick versus Wesley So has an interesting endgame, but the game should be starting soon. But I think this position is technically drawn. Wait, did Wesley So calculate this?
He spent 2 minutes. Looks like. Or maybe, maybe not. I don't know.
Wait, isn't he just losing? Takes king d2, king d5, king c3, and white has two reserve moves with the a3 and a4,
yeah.
While black has only one.
But, you know, black can play king d6, not king d5. He can wait for white to play king c3.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter because white has two reserve moves.
Yeah, not just one. He has
black
two.
King c3, king d5, a3. Black plays f6.
Oh no, he has f5 followed by h5 and then h4. Ooh. So that's his idea.
Wesley So with the tricks.
Wow.
Oh nice.
Wesley So with the tricks. Okay, we'll have
to again the angry cat. The angry cat with desperate to win. My coach Mel.
Yeah,
once again.
Then, because you know, White can just go back and forth on c2 and d2. It's just a draw.
I mean, still f5 is something to consider there.
You don't react to that because you can just take back.
Yeah, they're just the mind squares. They're just avoiding the mind squares. So
that's
basically a simple endgame situation. Melick's calculating that, and our game still haven't started. That's a surprise.
Yeah, kind of delay. Technically should have started like 5 minutes ago, but not sure what is going on there. Hopefully start soon.
Oops.
Calm down from that ending.
Oh my god. It's actually sort of crazy that Kessov even got the chance to win. Because why did he have to play this move, the rook to b2 here, and just g4 followed by rook g2 to take the g3 pawn, right?
Yeah,
I mean, rook b2 was just not smart. That was an intense match.
Very intense, very intense. Well, thanks to everyone for tuning in. Of course, you're watching the San Jose Hackers fighting against the Webster Windmills. Down 1 point going into the last round. We need 3 out of 4 in order to advance to the next round of the playoffs.
This is all about pressure, how our team deals with the pressure, because I think first prize is $20,000.
Something like that.
Yeah, that's a lot. And even if we go to like fourth place, we still get a few $1,000.
Oh, and we've gotten into the King of Pawn endgame. Very interesting. So King D2 on the board. And, you know, Malik, I mean, Christopher, I'm sure you know this. Malik is, he likes the endgame. So he's capable of calculating these King and Pawn endgames very, very carefully.
Yeah, very thoughtful for you to say nice things about my coach, so I appreciate it.
Of course, I mean, Malik's a good friend of mine. We go way back.
Yeah.
So the games looks like they have started. We have Kasov playing black against Ashwin Jayaram. Mamedyarov playing white against Alex Shimanov. And we've got a Fian Keto Kings Indian. Both players are very, very familiar with this opening, so this will be fun to watch. Zviad Azoria playing white against Vasif Durabaili. Looks like we transpose into Queen's Gambit accepted. The knight c3 move already inserted. And on the final board, we have Fike playing his typical modern defense against Mr. Sepe. I'm just going to call him Peter Sepe. Or maybe his name is Sepe De Vries Peters. I think De Vries is his middle name, Peter's last name. Okay, I'll call him Peters.
He's a pretty good, he's not quite as strong as these other guys you see, but he's pretty good. He's a 2200-ish free day, 2225-ish.
He played a great game against Kasov. I mean, he just really messed it up though in the time trouble, which is to be expected at this point in the Pro Chess League.
Yeah. Tons of crazy stuff has been happening, like Nakamura surprising result. F6, okay.
On the board.
Whoa. I mean, I don't know this line that well.
I don't think anyone knows this.
I mean, well, Fight should be playing this rule.
It's C3, I mean, still. Both sides playing quickly. I feel like they're not exactly in theory here. I could be wrong, but I just feel like both players are kind of just improvising.
Kind of, they know their opponent doesn't know, but they kind of want to just make the impression that they know.
Right, neither player knows, and they're both trying to pretend that they know. They're playing poker right now, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because they can't actually see their emotions because they're playing online.
Right, over the board, it'd be very easy to tell if someone is actually calculating or is within the preparation. Online, no idea.
Yeah. I wonder if Sepe De Vries is a good opening player, because the last game he got a very good position out of the opening.
Yeah, here we see Bishop F4, and if take on e5, he can just recapture either with the bishop or the knight because of the pin.
Yeah, he's also planning to take, he's also just planning on taking f6 and playing bishop d6.
Right, so we have knight e7 on the board.
I mean, but if he takes on f6 and plays bishop d6, knight to f5, castles in draw should be fine.
Bishop d7.
I think we can castle here or play knight f5. I mean, it looks dynamically okay for black. I think this is a perfect opening, though, for Fike, because he doesn't have to find a way to imbalance the position. The position is already just very, very imbalanced, and he can comfortably, you know, take some risk. He knows the match situation. He knows he needs to play for a win. And this is a great position for him to do so.
Yeah.
Okay, so, I mean, really the only board where I feel like we're at a small disadvantage is board 3. With Kasov, what has happened here? Oh my god, I think Kasov might be busted.
Wait, he's lost a pawn already.
Ashwin, I mean, he just dropped this f7 pawn.
Wait, I wonder how he dropped it.
Just in a nice jumping game.
Why couldn't he just play h6 here?
Well,
and it's actually...
He's too worried about this bishop b5, so instead of playing h6, which is probably the only move, and just allowing this, he plays the other way, a6, and I think he just completely missed knight g5. You know, it's funny, I've actually seen Ashwin use this to beat a different player in an over-the-board tournament in a classical game. Actually, this was against, I think it was against his teammate, Josh Colas. Like, literally the exact same thing happened. Knights on g5 and e5, and Black had to give up the f7 pawn. And that was in the classical tournament, so full 90-minute time control.
Maybe Kasov should have played bishop to east, bishop to, bishop to d, bishop to d6. Sorry. Bishop to d6 here. And if bishop to b5, check king to e7.
Yeah,
maybe. Just staying calm.
Right.
Fine. I mean, just h6 next, then it's like staying calm, a6, c4, b5. And how does he exactly take advantage of this king?
Yeah, and just try to castle by hand. Chris, is your mic okay? There seems to be a lot of feedback coming from it. Are you're not like messing with your mic, are you?
I don't know. What's the problem with
it? It's like kind of going in and out. It's like,
it just sounds like you're like moving too much. So it's picking up too much background noise, amplifying it.
I just move.
Like if you're like fidgeting around in your chair. I don't know.
Yeah, I'll
move. Back to chess. Now you just sound really quiet.
Yeah, now you just went quiet.
Yeah.
Where's your microphone?
I have a microphone.
It's so it's built in the laptop, so maybe you should like move closer to the laptop and then just, you know, try not to move around too much.
That goes?
I think something went wrong with the mic. Because it really went quiet.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I don't have microphone.
I mean, and, you know, your webcam, it's acting as a microphone.
Oh.
Okay, meanwhile, I mean, yeah, Kasov is just down a pawn, and this is not going to be good. I'm going to switch to Mamadiarov's game. Very, very interesting. They had a Fianchetto King's Indian. And play this early f4, a4, and bishop f5. Nice move. Just putting a lot of pressure on white. And he takes on e4. So very interesting combo by black. It all started with this move a4. Which to me looks like a bit of home preparation. Culminating in this position, where black seems to be doing very okay. I mean, he's got very strong bishop on g7. Knight on g3 is just not a good piece, just has very few prospects.
Yeah, this looks really bad for white.
Yeah.
He can't even move any of his queenside pawns, or even Teruk on a1, really. a3 is just a weakness in the long run. But what else to play? Black might just play something like h5, h4,
yeah,
which he does, h5.
Yeah, I don't like this for white at all. He's going to have to figure something out here. Work some of his shach magic. Let's quickly switch over to Azoria's game. They went into this endgame, which often looks really dry, but I feel like white usually has some kind of chance here to create some problems. And you got the two bishops here. He's playing f3. e5 was played. Seemingly he was concerned about e4 kind of trapping his bishop in the middle of the board, so he had to give up a pawn. And yeah, knight bd5. Well, pawn up for white. We'll see if it's enough. Oh, sorry,
no,
not pawn up. Did white sacrifice the pawn, excuse me, and won the pawn back. Okay, so two bishops for white. King has yet to castle, so maybe some dynamic advantage here for white.
Yeah. Rook to a3. Azori is looking to convert. I'm really interested in what Mama's Day of is going to do in this position, because I am not liking it at all.
Yeah,
maybe
H5,
if
he's going into the tank.
If f5, h4, or so. Some issues there.
Which game are you looking at right now?
I'm looking at Mamadeo's game. I'm wondering what Mamadeo's gonna do. He's spending a lot of time. I don't think that after queen 3-7 he should have played knight to g3. I mean, even in this tradition, I don't exactly understand why that was necessary to put that knight on g3.
Well, I guess he just doesn't have anything better. Maybe knight g5, but then f4 would be hanging after you bring it back to f3.
Maybe I'm thinking about just letting black take the knight. But the problem is his b2 pawn here.
Yeah, but then white's pawn structure is so much worse.
Just wondering, because Mamadeyev almost seems lost is the funny thing. He's threatening h4. Is Mamadeyev going to play king to g2, knight to h1, but then h3 checkmate, so... Mamadeyev has to figure out some way to keep this game alive and keep our chances of staying in the playoffs.
Yeah, I don't like it. Only chance I see is like rook g1 and then queen g2 and then knight f5. But not enough time. Not enough time to do it. Just plays h4 next move.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah.
Okay, gonna need some magic from Shock and need some real wizard's magic. I'm gonna switch to Fike's game because this is gone. This just looks very messy. And we have knight takes d5 on move 16, winning a pawn for white just based on the pin on the e-file. I think Shock missed this, or Fike missed this. He trades queens, he plays rook d8, knight comes in.
I also don't like this position.
Black is down a pawn here, e6 is hanging. The only way Fike has a chance here is if white, one of white's pieces gets caught somehow.
Right now, Black is down 3 pawns, because he set the pawn in the opening also.
Ah, come on, Fike. Of course he did. Alright, the c5 pawn, he never won it back, did he?
Mm-hmm.
Wow, this is all not going our way in the last round.
Yeah, not looking good, to be honest. I mean, Shock definitely in big trouble. Zorya, he has an advantage, but he's not winning by any means. And Kasov has basically been losing for most of the game.
At least Kasov's he's a good fighter. He's good at defending bad positions, so we'll see what he comes up with here. What I'm really concerned about is Fike's game. Oh, Mamadeyev, he won. Did he rook to g1, Mamadeyev with the homemade tricks. Once again, Mamadeyev.
Well, he spent almost 4 minutes on rook f2, and I mean, for him, that's an hour in rapid chess.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm sure he calculated this ahead of time, but the question is it any good for white?
Yeah.
It's fancy, but I'm wondering if black even has to accept.
But yeah. I mean, two rooks in this position seems so favorable. A2's gonna fall, I'm pretty sure. And then white's king still seems weak.
Yeah, and then the knight just doesn't. I mean, queen and knight are usually a good combo, but the knight just doesn't really get in. You know, it just drops the bishop back to d4, and then rook b2, rook g1. So probably he can go for it. I imagine black can just retreat the queen. He'd also be doing okay. I don't know, maybe there's some tricks on the g-file.
Oh, I guess he's looking to sacrifice it for something like queen e7. He's gonna attack an exchange or something.
So, knight h5, bishop g1, rook g1. Then try to play queen c3 and knight f6.
Well, I mean,
it's an idea.
Actually, if the queen retreats, if either queen e3 or queen e7, there's knight f5, you don't even have to sacrifice.
Oh, that's true. Oh, yeah, in this line, it's good that there's no queen e4. I'm just showing this on my board, guys, but we'll have knight f6 check on the end. But yeah, I think you're right. I think you can also just play knight f5.
Wait, what game are you talking about?
We're still on Mamadyarov's game.
Oh, okay.
So we're examining if black just retreats, just queen e7, and can white just play knight f5 there, and is that any good for white? So knight f5, queen f6. I don't know. We don't have the rook sack because black just
I'm asking, why not queen to e3? Were you thinking about rook a to f1, rook takes a2, knight to f5 then? Interesting.
Queen e3 is possible for sure.
I mean, rook af1, threatening knight f5 is a possible idea after that.
Rook takes a2, knight f5.
Yeah, so Moradiabadi, he's a tricky fighter in bad positions.
Very, very tricky. Yeah, I mean, very instructive moment, you know. A terrible position after h5, we all agree. But he found a way to get some ideas going. Very nice.
Rook f2.
Fikes down four pawns.
Is he up a piece? No.
No. He has to have knight d4, and then they can h2 to have at least some counterplay, but still three pawns. That's way too much.
That's not good.
Worst case scenario, black can be down two pawns for nothing.
You mean best case?
No, I meant best case scenario. So let's hope Mike somehow figures out a way to do that with rook takes a2, knight takes d2. You know, it'll take some miraculous defensive skills if he's going to draw this one. It's happened before in the Pong Chesley.
Oh, I mean, crazier things have happened, yeah.
Yeah, what did Kesov do to his b7 bishop? All of his pawns are in light squares, and he has a light squared bishop, and that's not a good sign. Somebody like Capablanca would never be proud of this. His bishop is just blocked by his own pawns. Well, maybe he was thinking about a move like a5 and b4. But his bishop is still not very good there, so...
No, this is going to be rook f6 and...
Maybe... Yeah. Black could think of bishop to c8, and if g4 happens, bishop to d7 and bishop to e8. Just to somehow try to survive, but this bishop... That's what's holding Black's position is this bishop. I mean, it's just a bad bishop. He loves to have a bishop.
A clinic here. I mean, even if white wasn't up a pawn, I mean, this would just be a very, very strong position for white.
Yeah.
So, just to remind the viewers, I mean, Webster, they need one win and one draw to basically clinch the match in their favor. So that's looking good for them right now. We're basically just going to need a miracle because this game just looks bad. Fike looks... completely busted. I mean, even if Sepe plays the endgame as well as he did in the previous round, I think he can still hold the draw against Fike here.
Wait, let's take a look at Moradiabadi's game because it's starting to go interesting if he plays.
Yeah, so yeah, even accepted the two rooks.
H4 should give at least a draw.
And F5. So white wants to crashing on g6. H4 is critical here because if the knight moves, there's rook e2 check, just winning the game on the spot. So white would have to take on g6.
But I don't think there's anything more than a draw for white. It's just bad for
black takes on g3. I mean, all of black's pieces are perfectly defended, and the most white can hope for here is a perpetual check, which isn't guaranteed, I think, because black has a lot of pieces. So from a practical perspective, h4 would be the way to go here for Shimanov, and I'm sure he's calculating that right now. I mean, he's aware of the match situation, so I would expect him to go for that.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, Azoria, he's sacrificed the pawn with this f5 move.
But now there seems to be like almost some kind of mating net. Oh, he's at least winning an exchange with bishop takes a8.
Yeah, he can take on a8 whenever he wants to, and I imagine he wants to also play bishop f4 and h4, h5, and announce.
Maybe g4 right here. G4 is an idea, and some h4 mating that stuff. G4, I mean, h4. Taking on a8. I like Azoria's position, but it's the other position. So Kesov is hanging on, but I still don't like his position.
Ooh, we've got G5 in Mamadjarov's game. Also looks very strong, not allowing white to crash in. I mean, Shimanov might just be going to play H4 and try to just win the game right away.
Yeah.
And so, wait,
Go ahead, Christopher.
Sorry to interrupt about the mass situation, but Melik actually fell for the trap against Wozniak, so...
I saw that. Yeah, I'll just show the viewers, because we were looking at this pawn in game. So we had everything basically we calculated, then F5, and that was game over. He took, and he missed this move because he spent, you know, a minute and a half here. So takes H5, and Black's outside passer is just too strong, so he just resigned in this position.
Yeah.
So Wesley So with the king and pawn endgame clinic. Okay, back to our match. Let's see, Fike has reduced the deficit. He is now down 3 pawns. For minimal conversation. He's attacking a piece, so that's good. And white is going to be exchanging rooks.
Yay, Fike, you haven't died yet. You haven't died for our team yet, because our team needs your win. Or needs your draw.
We need some Fike magic. Okay, I'm just going to check on Kesav's game. He needs some
miracles.
Kesav is still in the game. He's still in.
Yeah, he's gonna put a. He's hoping for some sort of fortress or some sort of that. he's hoping for somehow holding this very passive position.
No, I don't think it's possible. He's right gonna now. Play. We're just gonna play e4, king e3, king e2, king e4. Game's over.
Kesav is.
Got some counterplay, huh?
Kesav looking for counterplay in a bad position, and it's not just a good decision in real games. I think it's especially good because our team sort of in a desperate situation. We would really want to get into the top 8 teams. That's something to be proud of, but we might not make it if Kesav somehow doesn't prove a result here. So Kesav also doing it for the team.
Yeah, I mean, basically at this point we're losing on 3 boards. Kesav, Fike, and I think Shock is still in big trouble. After g5 in that game, we had queen c3. So his idea was h4, not knight h5. That would allow rook e3. Or rook e2 check first, and then rook e3, but probably knight f1. And cover e3, and if rook e2 check, he can take the bishop. But instead, we have rook e5, queen f3, and now g4 on the board. And I think the two rooks are just outplaying the queen here.
Why couldn't have he played h4 here? Oh, queen g5.
Yeah, and that is resignation.
Bishop
e3. Strong move, bishop e3, and just instant, immediate resignation.
Oh, wow.
So tough game. He ran into
It's looking sort of hopeless.
He ran into almost. Some very, very nasty opening preparation here with this move a4. Is Shimanov was playing very, very quickly up until this point, and then all these ideas with bishop f5, I mean, just a very, very well-prepared game, leading to this, all these exchanges where Black's position at the end was just, I mean, almost winning here with this knight on g3 just being so, so bad. Uh-huh. And then, I mean, credit to Shimanov, I mean, I think he just played a fantastic game. So we're gonna need 3 wins from our remaining boards.
There's a 1 out of 100 chance, but I think that our story will be in the chess newspapers if we somehow do this.
So you're saying there's a chance.
Well, I'm saying that it's extremely low, but we're just gonna have fun in case these are our last moments commentating on our team. We're just gonna use all of it on these last 3 games. So we're going to commentate with as much energy we have, because we're saving the best for last.
Quite nice, mate. Bishop f3, king h4, bishop f4, rook takes e7, rook h3, check bishop takes
h3, g3. That's gorgeous. Are we going to see that on the board? Bishop f4 takes rook h3?
Oh my my god!
That's beautiful. Oh my god.
Oh, is Let's this go.
Bishop F4?
Okay, Bishop F4. Bishop F4. Bishop F4.
Oh, he plays it. Nice.
Game of the day.
I mean, straight out of you know, the Polgar book, the big checkmate book. Unbelievable.
This has. I'm not even sure if this make has ever happened in a real game. So, what a way to end it. Even Very if nice. We don't. Even if we'll probably not make it to the next round, I'm very swim. Wow, this is a nice checkmate. I just want to see it played on the board, so yeah, I'm just... Wow.
You gotta allow it. If he resigns here, oh my god, that'd be the worst sportsmanship I've ever seen. You gotta allow the checkmate.
Gotta.
Come on, I mean, they're winning the match, you know, the other two boards are just gonna be... Basically, they need one draw from two hopeless positions on our end, so...
If he wants popularity, he should just take the rook and go for this.
Yeah.
He might wow. just try to attack, even though it's completely losing the rook EGA, but this is take and G3.
Yeah. Wow, this but is an absolutely
even if you have even rook EGA, you still have rook
EGA. There we go. He allows it. Good sportsmanship. Yeah, okay. Good sportsmanship from Dora nice. Bailey. And let's mm-hmm. see it on the board.
G3. Checkmate! Nice. Wow, look at this!
The first, not the last.
Absolute beauty! This is almost like a study. This is like white to play and mate and four.
Yeah, I mean, you guys this have seen those studies, right? Where it's like king is on f4, and then the idea is rook h3, pawn takes g3, and there's a pawn on h5, right? And it's just the mate.
Yep.
This is like a very unique version of that with the two bishops.
Yeah. Wow, it's very rare to see such a thing in an actual chess game. Our two guys, we appreciate them for their experience in the Pro Chess League. It'll take, imagine if both of the guys lost internet connection, then we'll win. That
that's our only chance. So yeah. Hopefully that'll be move of the week. I don't know if you guys saw Nakamura's game earlier, but he got mated basically with a queen sack. So that will be our number one competition for move of the week. But this bishop f4 was fantastic. Definitely making the highlights at least for the week.
I mean, even if we're knocked out, we want the move of the week award so we can end it off good. It's looking sort of hopeless here. The only thing that can happen is bad internet connection, but I'm pretty sure
we need a tornado to hit Missouri like right now, basically.
Yeah. Well, power outage has just gone.
Yeah, I mean it's not impossible. You know, I lived in St. Louis for a year and a half. The weather was bad. B4 is a good move, forcing the trade of rooks.
Yeah,
it's gonna. Now, even if the internet does go out, you know, we only have a bishop on this board.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Just out of mating material. I'm going to switch to Kasov's game. Looks like he has a lost king and pawn endgame.
Yeah.
And, wraps up the match.
That seems like the end of our Pro Chess League because of this match. Come on, promote to a knight. Aww, come on. G6, look at, he's being nice. King f6, come on. Queen g8, mouse whip.
Still winning.
We lose. Okay, Fike's losing too, so we basically lost the match already. Oh, that's a painful way to lose it. I mean, it's possible to win 3-1, but yeah. The wrong performance at the wrong moment cost us, unlike some matches. Well, we lose. I'm watching this game get finished off. F7, and now even if Fike somehow manages to stalemate, which is a 1 out of 5,000 chance, still, our team can't win. I mean, even if there's a 1 out of 1 trillion chance that he's gonna win this position, 1 out of 1 tillion chance, taking it to the maximum of numbers. Yeah. Okay, I mean, fight
basically just, wraps yeah, up fight our season. Just flag. So final score that round was looks like 3-1 in favor of Webster.
3-1 not the way around. Wrong way.
Yeah, we got the right score, but just the wrong the wrong orientation. So final score, that means 6.5, 9.5. So congrats to Webster. I mean they really just outplayed us today. I think they played fantastic chess, you know, the whole day. I think it was very close. I mean, we definitely had chances in all the rounds, you know. Definitely dropped a yeah. half point here or there. But well, what are you gonna do? You know, can't win them all.
Yeah.
But what a great match to commentate on. So thank you guys so much for joining me this match, and of course the whole season. It's been a lot of fun to work with you guys.
Thank you. Bye.
And looks like we'll be signing off. Thank you so much to the fans for watching. We'll be posting the full show on YouTube and the highlights as well sometime this week, and we'll be back next year.
Hopefully, yeah. Thanks for tuning in. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.